you and thank you, because this is the way it's supposed to work. Each one is to carry each other's burden, and so that's why we spend so much time on Hagman and Hagman as the Lord leads, praying for people. Thank you all very, very much. And tonight we're going to try, Tim and I, by the grace of God, are going to lay out to you the confusion in the terminology that keeps people from truly identifying not only the enemy, everybody can look to see Satan as the root of it all, but they don't understand the different terms and why Genesis 6 is so critical and why the church and organized religion won't touch this with the truth of God's word and why it's been pretty much hidden through the ages. Because when you start talking about fallen angels, when you start talking about war in heaven, when you start talking about sexual impurity, and so much so that a third of the angels fell, not in the original rebellion, but only 200 of them came to earth as watchers on Mount Hermon in the Middle East and had sex with the earth woman. Now, we're going to open with the scripture, and I want everyone to take notes because it's imperative that you understand this. There are so many people using and misusing the word Nephilim. Most people don't even address the word Rephaim, and most people call Nephilim demons. It's not the case. And in order to understand this, because as Tim and I go into the evening and we share with you the not only the ancient text, but the actual words in Hebrew and in Greek, a picture is painted that has been kept from the people of God. You know, Doug, Joe, and Tim, I just got off the phone with a lady that said, I don't even know how I heard about you, but I was praying, and the Lord said, I want to teach you the nature of the war that you're going to be fighting. And she said, I was led to you. And ladies and gentlemen, the point is that it's the message that is critical. You're all charged by the living God to take these things to the scripture and to pray about them. And I find it's interesting, Doug, you know, most people will deal with sex. They deal with it in you know, righteously so and rightfully so in marriage. But if you notice the nature of the battle now throughout all of the media and through all of the different portals from hell, everything is becoming more and more perverse. And I think it goes to the amazing words of Jesus. And again, everything that Jesus said has such a depth of, a depth to be mined to understand what he is really saying, that when he's calling people, ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father will you do also. I mean, he's making a statement, and so we're going to get to that. But tonight we're going to open, and Tim and I are going to go back and forth as Pastor Langford and all guests do. But this is critical. People, you need to open your Bible, and you need to write these scriptures down, because they mean what they say and say what they mean, and because of the organized religious world avoiding it doesn't make it not true. Genesis 6, starting at the first verse. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became the mighty men which were of old, men of renown. And God said, and God saw the wickedness of man that was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. I think the idea of the fall of man and the denial of the true person of the devil, who became the adversary, Satan means the adversary, that Genesis 6 is what I call the Rosetta Stone to understanding history. Up until the time of a French explorer, if you will, Champollion, no one could rightfully and accurately read hieroglyphics, but with the archaeological find of the Rosetta Stone, which was written in three languages, in other words, the same passage, but it was written kind of, if you will, as a primer to be able to laid hieroglyphics into Dometic, and then Dometic was kind of a syllable by syllable sound. We would call it a phonetic alphabet, and then into Greek. So with that understanding through the Rosetta Stone, Rosetta Stone, came the understanding of hieroglyphics. And it's interesting, Doug, it's interesting, Joe, it's amazing, Tim, that when the Tower of Babel was built, and obviously Nimrod, and we're going to get to him later in the show, that there was a desire of mankind to escape the flood and to build a tower whose height reached to heaven. It was so real and so or such an affront against the living God that he scrambled the languages on the plains of Shinar. Well, right now, as the world comes together in a global, if you will, rebuilding of not only the Tower of Babylon, but the last, if you will, expression of a global government, a global religion, and a global financial system, it's Babylon 2. And it was interesting because there was a science fiction show that took place in space by that name. But getting back to Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, here's what I think people need to understand. It was Arthur Cousins who said, the climax was at the beginning. When God so chose in the book of Genesis to make it clear, he didn't give at that point the total, forgive me, Moses in writing Genesis didn't give the entire account, but he gave enough to show that there was a heavenly interference on earth. And for the people, we'll get to the whole thing of sons of God and who they were, etc. But one of the words that's interesting that shows up three times in the Old Testament is the word Nephilim, N-E-P-H-I-L-I-M. And over the course of the last, I don't know, probably 20 years since I started talking about it, I've seen the most strange renditions of that. And Tim and I were talking, and before I go into the Hebrew and all that stuff, the point is that Nephilim is not the same as Rephaim. People use Nephilim as giants. Nephilim are not giants. Nephilim are fallen angels. The giants, eight times in the Old Testament, are spoken of in the valley of the Rephaim, or they're from the root word Rapha, R-A-P-H-A. Demons are the disembodied spirits of the giants, half heaven, half earth. And you know, Doug, Joe, and Tim, God, and I'm turning right over to Tim, God set a balance. He set a separation. In the book of Genesis, he said, everything after its likeness and after its kind. Since that decree went forth, the devil and all of his fallen angels, one-third of the angels in heaven fell, have been trying to distort, destroy, mix, intermingle, genetically alter, genetically pervert, and basically do every form of attack on the human genome created in the image and likeness of the living God. Go ahead, Tim. Share, if you would, just what's on your heart, because obviously God has raised you up to deal with these issues and in a pretty remarkable way. Ladies and gentlemen, the Alberino analysis, if you'll go on my website, stevequayle.com, is probably one of the most, and I say this not to flatter Tim, but it's one of the most laser-like presentations of some of the most difficult things to understand, but Tim has a gift of making it simple. Go ahead, Tim, and respond, if you would, to the general statement that everything's a Nephilim.
Yep. On that note, I want to let everybody know that we just upgraded the analysis. That's going to be coming out tomorrow or Wednesday, so there's an upgraded version coming. But yeah, the word Nephilim, for some time now I've been bothered by this very general use of the term Nephilim. The word Nephilim has become a trendy part of people's vernacular. And there's a tendency to over-apply it lackadaisically and to generalize when dealing with the reality of non-human sentient beings. And even the term non-human sentient beings throws people for a loop, because people can understand the idea of giants, but it's hard for them to then apply the same kind of logic to understanding the existence of other sentient non-human entities. And the reality is that the days in which we live are going to be especially the days that are coming in the future, are going to be filled with the reality of non-human sentient entities. And we can just point to the book of Revelations to verify that. There's all kinds of creatures appearing on the scene at the end of the age. And so I think it's important for us to be able to get away from the term Nephilim in the way that it's being used and begin to break down the paradigm of what's actually happening on the earth right now. And what really disarms people is when a term is used so amorphously, so generally, that it begins to lose its meaning, or it begins to be applied to every single situation that is unexplainable or that has to do with non-human intelligence. And I'll give you an example. I've heard people refer to UFOs as Nephilim. In fact, this is quite common. And I think that this is something that people need to start correcting. I really believe that this isn't just an issue of semantics. This is a paradigm shifter, what Steve and I are talking about tonight. This is a paradigm shifter for people. People need to shift out of the common cookie-cutter paradigms and move into understanding reality. And it's so convoluted. There's so much going on that we've got to have our heads screwed on right, and we've got to have our minds wrapped around some of the terminology and some of the issues that are going on. And so, again, going back to this issue of people labeling UFOs or flying saucers or aeronomical unidentified or unexplainable aeronomical phenomenon as Nephilim. And again, this is very common. So the problem with that is, and I understand where people are coming from. They're wanting to say that that is evil, that's wicked, that's of the devil. And in that sense, they're accurate. But in describing a vehicle as a Nephilim, they're missing a whole lot of information that they need to start to understand. For example, an aircraft, a UFO, a flying saucer is hardware. It's hardware. It can crash. It can explode. It can be brought down with centralized or focused radar systems or missiles. It's hardware. So we have a lot of things going on in the atmosphere. For example, using the UFO situation as an example here, there's a lot of things flying around in the atmosphere, and none of what's actually flying around, in my opinion, it can be rightfully labeled with the term Nephilim. Now, some of the entities flying the craft maybe might fit some of that terminology, and obviously fallen angels are involved. So, again, my hope tonight is to kind of help people break down some of the confusion, because fallen angels, or some people like to call them archons or watchers, like I always say, that's the term angel is a very broad, general term. And there are a lot of fallen creatures, in my opinion, that, and it's not just my opinion, this can be verified in Scripture, obviously the giants that came of the Nephilim, that came of the Watchers, are a different, there's different categories. So the fallen angels are very, very distinct from the giants. They're human hybrid offspring. But see, the fallen angels didn't just screw around sexually with human women, and we're going to get to this a little bit later when we talk about the Book of Giants. They intentionally screwed around with all kinds of animals, and not just a couple. And again, we'll get to the details in a little while. So what you have now is you literally have a situation where there are multitudes of creatures, sentient creatures. When I say sentient, I'm talking about conscious. They have the ability to think consciously like us. They have the ability to reason and to, and they're intelligent. And in many cases, they're far more intelligent than we are, and they're going to be showing up on the scene pretty soon. This is a safeguard, by the way. This is a safeguard against deception. This isn't just peripheral information. This is information that is going to help people, if they apply it and take it seriously, it's going to help them recognize, discern, and identify the things that are happening on the earth. Because the kind of stuff we're talking about tonight, namely sentient non-human creatures, because that's what the giants were. They were hybrids. They were only partly human, and that's what all the other creatures that came of the fallen angels mixing their seed with the animals and other creatures. And so we're dealing with this litany of beings that are going to start showing up, at least some of them. And when they do, if you don't have a grid, if you don't have a paradigm that's ready for it, it's going to throw you for a loop. And that's putting it lightly. I mean, listen, people are going to lose their faith. Some people are going to lose their minds over some of the stuff that's coming. And I don't mean to be ambiguous. Specifically, there is this whole alien question that we've got to wrap our minds around. We've got to start to understand the alien question. We have to understand UFOs better. That doesn't mean that you have to become a ufologist, but we've got to understand this stuff, not only in a biblical context, which is the most important, but also in the context of reality, what is actually taking place on the earth right under our noses. Steve?
Well, I think it's important, too, to understand the words, and this is what's interesting. In Genesis 6:4 and Numbers 13:33, where the word Nephilim is used in the Hebrew, it literally translates from the word Nephal. Some people pronounce it Nepal, and by the way, the country of Nepal, or Nepal, where the Mount Everest is called the Mountains of the Fallen Ones. Just a little curiosity there. But some of the greatest scholars, okay, specifically say that the word Nephilim refers to the fallen angels themselves and not to their offspring, which brings me to a word for their offspring. You know, it's interesting, Tim, Doug, and Joe, that the Bible teaches very clearly that Satan can literally transmutate or change his form and appear as an angel of light. Tim and I will get to that later on in the show, and we're going to talk specifically about the Book of Giants, which is a Dead Sea Scroll found in the Qumran caves, along with the different fragments of Scripture. The problem is that people will look to an alien savior, but they will not look to the God who spelled it all out for them so they wouldn't be deceived. And Scripture says because they choose to believe a lie, God gives them up that they might believe a lie. One of the things I get into a lot of, email discussion, and people take me on over my biblical stance. When you tell me that the aliens created us, my first question, and I think you and I talked about this, Doug, and you don't have to answer because you're through, but I'm just saying we've talked about it, is the fact that who created the aliens. And I find it interesting that the alien gods that people want to worship are always related mythologically and through legends and through oral tradition with the sexual act of supernatural beings producing offspring in the woman. Now, the word Rephaim, which is a derivation of Rapha, and that's a pretty interesting thing. It basically talks about ghosts of the dead, shades, or spirits. And I think Chris Putnam's got something written on shades. But here it is. I'm going to give people, if you look at the word dead in the Old Testament, and please take these, it's important for the sake of this talk tonight that I give these scriptures so people can go and look it up in the Hebrew concordance, either Strong's or Young's, okay? Job 26:5 says this, dead things are formed from under the waters and the inhabitants thereof. Now look at that, dead things. Okay, people say, well, what are they talking about, drowned ghosts? No, they're talking about, I'll say this, the giants or the Rephaim are formed from under waters. That's the word, and the inhabitants thereof. Now, how about this? Psalm 88:10. Wilt thou show wonders to the dead? Shall that dead rise and praise thee? Salah. How about Proverbs 2:18? For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead, unto the Rephaim. Proverbs 9:8. But he knoweth not that the dead are there, and her guests are in the depths of hell. The sexual connotation of the whole fallen angel and let's just call it intergalactic or interdimensional hanky-panky, is beyond question. The bottom line is you can't get away from the Greek gods, the Greek myths. You can't get away from the Egyptian myths. You can't get away from any of the Babylonian myths. You can't get away from the Epic of Gilgamesh, the oldest poetic narrative in the world. You can't get away from Nimrod. You can't get away from this stuff in history because it infiltrates every aspect of the secret societies and the occult worship of Lucifer. Okay, how about Proverbs 21:16? The man that wandereth out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. That's the Rephaim. This is one of my favorites, Isaiah 14:9. Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. It stirreth up the dead, Rephaim, for thee, even all the chief ones of the earth, it has raised up from their thrones, and all the kings of the nations. Isaiah 26:14 and Isaiah 26:19. They are dead, they shall not live. They are deceased, they shall not rise. Therefore hast thou visited and destroyed them, and made all their memory to perish. Isaiah 26:19, thy dead men shall live together with my dead body shall they arise. Awake and sing, ye that dwell in dust, for thy dew is a dew as herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead. That again is the word Rephaim. So every time you see the word dead in that context of those passages, I think there's eight of them, you've got to understand it's speaking about the Rephaim. So it's real simple. Again, we're going to build on this. The Nephilim are the fallen ones. The Rephaim are the giants. The word Rephaim and Nephilim are not interchangeable, though current usage and confusion would make it so. And as Tim just spelled out, a UFO is not a Nephilim. You're talking about, in essence, it's almost like some of the fallen angels may have had their wings clipped, pun intended, and had to use the technology of the ancients. I was told, Doug, Joe, and Tim, by a multi-star general beyond most people's ability to understand rank in the military, that the idea of the understanding that they've been given are of so many sentient beings in the universe that they basically battle so many of them. It's kind of like in our, if you will, understand the world, we got three things, and they're all rolled into one. We have, obviously, fallen angels, we have giants, and we have the demons. A demon literally means a disembodied spirit. A demon has to inhabit something. A demon can inhabit an inanimate object, it can inhabit an animal, it can inhabit just about anything, idols, stone, whatever, until they ultimately become if you will, animated in their own body or take possession of another. So what we're talking about, too, is when a demon enters in, when an unclean spirit enters in, let's take the words of Jesus, the gathering demoniac. The gathering demoniac was chained to a wall, but the demons in him, which were named Legion, produced so much strength that the chains couldn't hold him until Jesus, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, commanded that unclean spirit, the unclean Legion, to come out of him. And those demons, what did they do? They begged to go into the pigs. And then the pigs immediately ran off the cliffs and drowned. And it's fascinating because one of those scriptures of Rephaim is specifically talking about that which is under the sea. So the point is that the demons are what are manifesting. And I'm going to ask Tim to share, I'm going to share an email that I got from a lady. I'll hide her identity. So sister, if you're listening, don't worry. But Tim, I want you to share what happened, because I think people need real-life instances. We're not here to scare you. We're here to tell you that in my name ye shall cast out devils. God has given us power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. So, Tim, share about the gentleman, and obviously you don't need to share his name. Don't share any names, but just share about the experiences that you had with this sort of stuff in Peru.
Yeah, specifically, the idea, many people are familiar with the terms incubus and succubus, which basically refer to entities, demonic entities that actually, for lack of a better term, rape human beings. And that's not in an imaginary sense. That's in a very literal sense. That sounds bizarre to most Americans because That kind of stuff is under the radar here. It's happening here, as Steve's going to demonstrate, but it's under the radar here, whereas if you go to third world countries, things are much more overt and in your face. In fact, there was a – for the listeners who don't know, I lived in the Amazon basin of Peru for 10 years. So there was a young man from a church in the United States that wanted to come down and spend some time in Peru with us. And we were engaged, my wife and I, and a team of Peruvian people, in really intense intercession. So there was always supernatural stuff happening around us because we were engaging the supernatural. We were engaging the atmosphere, and there was a lot of pushback. So I warned this young man. I said, listen, if you come down to Peru, you have to understand that you're walking into a war zone, especially if you're going to get enveloped with us. You've got to be prepared. And you know, he assured me he was, and he came down to Peru, and he didn't have a real, this guy had a very superficial relationship with the Lord. I would question whether he really did know the Lord, but to give him the benefit of the doubt, I'll just call it a superficial relationship with the Lord. But anyways, he comes to Peru, and within the first week, I would say within the first couple of days, he was living down the road from my wife and I. We were staying with some friends. He was staying in a like an apartment room down the road from us by himself. And I think it was the second night or the third night, he came to the door of the house that I was staying at around 1 or 2 in the morning. And I hear this knocking at the door, and he's calling my name frantically. And so I went to the door, and I opened the door, and listen, this guy, he had the crap scared out of him. I mean, he was pale. His skin was pale. He was sweating. He was shaking like a leaf. And the look on his face was utter horror. And I said, what's the problem? And he said, I have to talk to you. I have to talk to you right now. And he started to break down and cry. So he came in, we sat down, and he was weeping for a couple of minutes, and I said, what happened? He said, and I'm sorry if this is a big pill to swallow for people tonight, but he looked at me and said, I just got raped by something. And basically, he was, and by the way, this young man was definitely playing with sexual immorality. That's a key point here. He was playing with fire before he came to Peru. Okay, so he told me he just got raped by an unseen entity, and he began to tell me what happened. And basically, without going into the details, obviously, he was having a dream. He was having a normal dream, laying in his bed on his back, having a normal dream, but then suddenly his dream was interrupted, and it went to another level. There's probably some listeners who understand what that's like. When you're having a sort of a normal dream that's not really important, and maybe kind of a ridiculous dream, and then all of a sudden your dream gets notched up to a whole new level, and you are consciously aware that something's going on. You know you're dreaming, and either it's really good or really bad what's happening in your dream. It's either God giving you a message, or it's somebody else infiltrating your dreams. And so he was in that heightened state of dreaming all of a sudden, and of course he had the sleep paralysis, and he was now in between being awake and being asleep, and this entity entered his dream and basically became his dream. It was this female entity, and it was coming on to him, and it was he said at first it presented itself in an attractive form, and so it started to come on to him, and so he responded, and basically he was making out with this entity in the dream, and then of course they started to round third base, and suddenly he woke up, and he was no longer in the sleep paralysis state. He was wide awake. But he was stuck to his bed. He was literally being pushed down into his bed. And there was an entity on top of him. The bed was being pushed down by the extra weight. It was a full-on physical experience. But I can't really remember if he could see the entity. I think he did, but I don't want to over-exaggerate. I don't want to exaggerate, but he definitely could feel it. It was a physical presence. It was pushing him down, and it was having sexual intercourse with him, and it was a female entity, and it was terrifying because he definitely did see it, at least a glimpse of it, because it wasn't beautiful anymore. Now it was a terrifying, demonic, horrifying entity that was raping him. And he was literally held down to his bed and basically became, you know, like a prostitute to this entity. It was having its way with him, and there was nothing he could do about it. And it was abusive. It began to become very abusive and dig its claws into him. And it was a terrifying experience for him. Believe me, this was not a pleasurable experience for this young man. He was absolutely terrified. And the thing started to move around his room. I think it knocked some things over. I think it was growling. There was a whole scene going on. So there's physical contact going on. And he didn't know what to do. And because he had opened the door, he really didn't have the authority. He was disarmed spiritually. And I'm not going to go into the details of exactly why, but it had to do with sexual immorality. He had a door open before he came to Peru. And he entered the battlefield, and, somebody took advantage, something took advantage of that open door in his life. And that's why I always tell people, when the Bible says that when not to give the devil a foothold, that's literal. It's not just metaphoric. It's not just poetic language. It's literal. If you give the devil a foothold, in other words, the old saying, if you give him an inch, he'll take a mile. If you crack the door open for him, he's going to bust it open. And obviously, depending on the state of where you are with the Lord and everything like that, will determine what happens at that point. But this young man was not on solid ground, and so he paid the price. And he was, like I said, he was white as a ghost, shaking like a leaf, bawling his eyes out. Nothing like this had ever happened to him in his life. And so this is the reality. So when we talk about sentient entities or sentient beings or non-human entities or whatever terminology we're using, we're not talking about spirits that just float around like clouds and just kind of drift in and out of rooms like ghosts. Get the idea of just ghosts out of your head. These are flesh, in some cases, flesh and blood. In other cases, they're quasi-supernatural. In other words, they can be flesh and blood one moment, and then they move into another dimension or realm or whatever, or dematerialize or whatever they do. But they have physical interaction, and this guy learned that the hard way.
Well, I think it's important too that people understand that there's a scripture for this. One thing that I've always asked the Lord, I said, Lord, help me not to veer, help me not to stray. And I've been rebuked by so many, and I'll just say this: ignorant Jezebel-like creatures. And I'm not even sure. I basically have, people said, do you know what they say about you? I said, I don't care what they say about me. What does the Bible say about all this stuff? And here it is, Jude 1, 6 through 11. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains unto darkness, unto the judgment of the great day. People said, well, Jesus said there's no sex in heaven. Absolutely, not in heaven. But these guys left their first estate. That means they didn't stay in the heavenly realm, and they intermingled themselves with the seed of man. By the way, one of the derivations, I found this, it blew me away, Tim, I didn't know this. Basically, one of the Hebrew definitions of Nephal, N-I-P-H-A-L, is to come down into and penetrate, okay? But it's literally a true statement to say they inserted themselves into the human genome. Now listen to this. This is where Jude deals specifically with what Timothy just basically spelled out in the realm of supernatural rape. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire, likewise also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. Now, that's not just talking about an earthly entity. Now, how about this? Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, did not or durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, and those things they corrupt themselves. That brute beast is not talking about just the nature of a fallen man. This is talking about entities. Now look at this. Woe unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain, and greedily after the heir of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Kor. All I'm saying to most people tonight, and Tim is saying, this stuff is upon us. Now to bring you fast forward. Tim, will you do me a favor? Are you where you can email me back the email that I sent you
yes.
with the lady who had the recent experience? If you'll send that, I'm going to paraphrase it. But I'd like to have it
yep.
just to see if I leave out any details. I was sent an email by a woman who's basically been chased. She's not seeing anyone. She's not been with a man. She sounded like a genuine sister in the Lord. She said to me, and I am praying for you, and we will pray for all people who are oppressed tonight of the devil. And John Quayle, blessings to you. I just bless my brother John Quayle. No man that I know right now, and anybody that is so selflessly trying to get people free and setting free. Now, I don't know all the deliverance ministers. I know that Shannon Davis prays for people on the radio, and God bless his efforts, and the other who minister on his show to set people free. But we're laying out for everyone to understand. This lady sends me an email, and it basically said, I've been chased. I'm getting to the bottom line. And I was raped by an entity. When a woman is raped by an entity, it's incubus. When a man is raped by a female entity, it's succubus. And ladies and gentlemen, if you don't think this is relevant tonight, when you're reading Psalm 91, the terror that comes by night was a Lilith, it's talking about Lilith the night hag. And in the desert settings, the female demoness would literally, and I got to be careful here because I don't want to be graphic, but let me just say this. The word man-eater, this beautiful woman would appear as a beautiful woman, rape the man, and then turn into the beast and devour them, literally eat their flesh. So in Psalm 91, when it talks, you won't be afraid of the terror that comes by night, okay? That's what it's talking about. People don't understand the specificity, there's a good word, for the Word of God. So the point being is when you're talking about what Tim and I are talking about, and I just told the woman that got raped, she ended up the following day, which she said, genital herpes pimples all over her, you know, private area. Now, is this to be talked about? Absolutely. The point being is this, is that I have seen too many people go into the night and walk away from the Lord because they'd seek help from ignorant, and I would say this, cowardly pastors who didn't have the words to set them free. And it's out in Jesus' name. And it's with the faith to know that. So what we're seeing in Jude 1, 6 through 11 is the angels which kept not their first state. In other words, they didn't stay in heaven. They were drawn away by their lusts. And it's an interesting thing. That word lust is amazing to me. It's epitomia in Greek. And this is amazing too. It is a desire, a craving for that which is forbidden. I asked the Lord years ago, and for those of you who have listened to me for two decades or better than two decades on the radio, I said, Lord, what's lust? And here's what he said, and I'll give it right back to you, Tim. It's the appetite of demons expressed through humans. Now, that's pretty telling. The appetite of demons expressed through humans. If you look at if I had to give you one statement, that's basically taking over the world. It doesn't matter if it's Germany passing a law that basically you can have sex, incest is going to be legal. I believe I stand corrected if I'm wrong, but I believe that they passed a law that sex with animals is legal, bestiality. The basis of all bestiality is simply this, and it's the basis of the Canaanite religions. The Canaanite religions practice incest, so do the Illuminati. The point being is that every barrier that God has placed for our safety now is broken down. And Tim, I'm going to turn it over to you. And I think we need to actually help the people to understand that this isn't a graphic novel. This isn't Monday night titillation ceremony. These are the actual things that are going to be released in the earth and are being released. Forgive me, not will be, are being released. When the gates of hell are opened, the bottom line is that I don't think people understand. That means everything that's been held back for our safety out of God's commensurate, immeasurable love for us, the redemption of the King of Glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, is now being loosed, and it's manifesting. Go ahead, Tim.
That's right. The term incubus, by the way, and succubus, I want to clarify this for people. That is what people have labeled these things, but don't be fooled in thinking that there's only two kinds of entities that can screw around with you physically, that one's called incubus and the other's called succubus. That's not the case. I'm not sure, Steve, but I think that the incubus and succubus came out of the medieval times, the terminology. But basically, my point is this. A lot of these entities, there's multitudes of them, they have the capability to interact with us in the material realm, in the corporeal world. Let me give another example here. This is actually pretty interesting, Steve, because when I was in Peru, I had a good friend, his name is Carlos. He and I would actually, this is when I was first coming, studying giants and everything, and there was a particular evening, it just so happened, Steve, that we were reading some of your stuff together, looking some stuff up, the Genesis 6 giants and all kind of stuff. And we ended up that night, talking about, for some reason, incubus and succubus. I don't remember why we were talking about incubus and succubus, because we started off talking about giants and Genesis 6 and all that. And it was about, I'd say, again, it was probably somewhere around 1 in the morning. My wife and child were asleep. Everybody was asleep. And my friend Carlos and I were sitting in my office, in my home in Tarapoto, Peru. And we're having this conversation about incubus and succubus. Can't remember the details of it, but I know that's what it was about. Now, my friend Carlos had a cell phone. This cell phone is one of those prepaid cell phones, the ones you buy and you put the little chip in it. And nobody had his number. Actually, I shouldn't say nobody. Let me be clear. Three people had his number, me and two friends of ours. That's it. And nobody else had his number. Nobody else called him because, number one, he didn't even speak Spanish. He didn't even speak Spanish, okay? So we're sitting there talking, 1 o'clock in the morning, incubus and succubus. He gets a phone call on his phone, and we look at each other because it was bizarre. Nobody had his number, and he doesn't speak Spanish, and yet he's getting a phone call at 1 in the morning. We look at each other. He answers the phone and just sort of slowly hands it to me because he doesn't speak Spanish and he doesn't understand Spanish. I take this little phone, and I say, "Hello?" And there is this voice on the other line. It is a deep, raspy, very demonic, malevolent voice. And it's laughing. And I say, "Who is this?" And he said, "You know who this is," in Spanish. I said, "No, I don't." I said, you have the wrong number. You know, this is my friend Carlos's phone, and he doesn't speak Spanish. You must have the wrong number." And he laughed at me. He said, "No, I don't have the wrong number. You know who this is." And I said, "No, I don't." I'm kind of starting to laugh a little bit now because it's awkward. And I'm looking at my friend Carlos, and I'm sort of whispering to him, "There's something strange going on here." And I said, "No, I don't know who you are. Tell me who you are." He said, "You were just talking about me." And I'm thinking, "We were just talking about you." And I said to my friend, "He said we were just talking about you, we were just talking about him." And Carlos says, "Incubus and succubus?" And he started to laugh. And he said, "Yes." He said, "I'm with you now," he told me. "I'm with you. I'm watching you." And I'm thinking, this is crazy. Nobody has this phone number. My friend doesn't speak Spanish. We're talking about incubus and succubus. And I get this phone call of this malevolent voice on the other end telling me he's watching me. He's, I guess, incubus or succubus or something to do with it. And he's laughing at me. And I don't remember, I honestly, I don't remember the way that conversation ended, but it was bizarre. because it was so uncanny. Again, I'm going to say it again. He just purchased this phone. Nobody had his number except for me and two other friends, and they were girls, young ladies. And how could anybody have known that we were talking about that at 1 in the morning? And my friend doesn't speak Spanish, so why would anybody even call his phone? My point in telling that story is that this stuff is real. It is real. And we're not trying to scare people, but the Bible says that men's hearts will fail them because of what's coming on the earth. So if you have the understanding and the paradigm for this stuff, it disarms fear. It disarms fear. We're not pushing fear. We want to disarm fear. And it's the knowledge of God. It's understanding the scriptures. It's understanding the world in which you live, because most of us just frankly don't understand the world in which we live. And let me tell one more little story, and I'll make it quick, concerning the reality of these entities entering into the physicality and screwing around with people. I had a young man who gave his life to the Lord. Well, again, I didn't know him long enough to see fruit, but you know, he prayed and he expressed that he wanted to give his life to the Lord, and so I led him through the prayer, and I told him he was a pot smoker. And I told him, I said, you need to stop smoking pot. Okay, so listen, there's probably some people listening to this broadcast tonight that smoke pot, that screw around with marijuana. Listen up. Because I've got some news for you right now. This guy, he wouldn't stop smoking pot. And he gave me, all the old arguments. And this was in Peru, by the way, and this is a Peruvian young man. He gave me all the old arguments about it's good for you, it heightens your sense of awareness and consciousness, and it makes you more intelligent and all this garbage. And I told him, I said, listen to me. You need to stop smoking marijuana because it's an open door. I told him that. I said, it's an open door, and I'm not going to sit here and try to explain to you why or how it's an open door. I'm just telling you that it is. And either listen to me and quit doing it or pay the price because it's an open door. And if you think that you're going to have a relationship with the Lord but yet hold on to the world, you have another thing coming, because it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. So this guy went back to his room that night after we had this conversation, and he had a dream. And this applies to other things, not just marijuana. This applies to a whole bunch of things, witchcraft, fornication. This applies to a bunch of things, any kind of drugs. He had a dream in which he was being invited into a home, and it was a very pleasant home. It had a nice yard. It was green grass, and the person that was inviting him into the home was dressed in white robes and was shining and beautiful. And so they're inviting him into the home, or the people. I can't remember if it was one or many, but there's definitely one central figure that he felt an affinity for. He felt very close to and warm and loving, like a spirit guide sort of a thing. And he goes into the house, and he walks into the living room. And the first thing he sees in the living room is a bunch of people sitting around smoking weed. That was all in the living room, and they're all sort of trying to be philosophical and the whole scene. But then this entity steps into the next room, and he's waving to him, and he says, come in this room. And to make a long story short, gradually as he moved through the house, it was getting darker and darker and scarier, and eventually he was being forced through the house. Until he came to, I forget if it was the courtyard or something, someplace in the house, where suddenly these creatures that seemed beautiful were now horrendous. They were monsters. They were demonic. And they all began to thrash him and to rape him. Well, he woke up. Guess what? Wasn't a dream. He was literally being thrashed, thrown around his room. Listen, everybody, I saw him the next day. He was beat up. I'm talking like if he got jumped in the street, he was beat up, he got thrashed. He got thrashed around the room, thrown out of his bed, and raped. And again, we're not saying this to scare anybody. This is called reality. But there's also the other side of this. Greater are those who are with us than those who are against us. When you realize, when you have interaction with this kind of in-your-face physical, manifest, demonic stuff, it just reinforces the fact that the King, Jesus Christ, is alive and real and tangible, and the hosts of heaven and the angels, it's all just as real, it's all just as tangible, and if you're walking in the kingdom And if you're walking in the power and you have a relationship with the Lord, then you have a host of allies, let's just call them, that are with you. The King of Kings is with you. The Spirit of God is in you. So that is what dispels the fear. That's what disarms the darkness. Nothing else will. Nothing else will. There is nothing on this earth that you can do if you are confronted by let's just say an alien, okay, in an abduction scenario. The only thing that you can do to get out of that is to have a relationship with the Lord, to call upon his name, and God will intervene. Divine intervention, that's the answer. That's the answer. You can't call on Hare Krishna. You can't call on Buddha. They're not going to answer. In fact, somebody else is going to come, and they're not going to be Hare Krishna, and they're not going to be Buddha. But if you have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, let me tell you, every knee bows to him. Every tongue confesses. He is the singularity of creation, and he is the initial singularity. Everything came from him. He is the master of the universe, and that is the only real safeguard to walk with him and to know him. So let me just affirm that and confirm that for anybody out there trying to say that Steve and I are preaching fair tonight. No, we're not. We're telling you reality, and then we're giving you the anecdote. We're giving you the weapons that you need. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. The weapons of our warfare are based in the spirit and the power of God. And the intimacy with Jesus. So I just want to reiterate that and affirm that, Steve.
Well, I think it's important, that people understand this. Now, you just talked about people getting beat up, okay? And the point being is that the Bible in the book of Acts even talks about the seven sons of Sceva. Or Sceva. Yep. The thing is it's interesting because guess what, ladies and gentlemen? When people who didn't know people who didn't know Jesus tried to cast out demons in his name, the bottom line is in the name of Jesus, the Spirit spoke to the people, obviously having sentience, having knowledge. And here's the other thing I want to share. One of the things that people get into is trying to get forbidden knowledge at the mouth of lying spirits. There is no, inquiry necessary. The Holy Spirit will tell you what to know. But I've watched people, Tim, and obviously John Kyle, we're told we can ask their names and how they entered and stuff. But, you know, you're not asking them for what the score of a baseball game, and I'm just making this up, you know, thousands of years ago was. You're talking about stuff that's real now. And in the book of Acts, seven sons of Sceva, these seven sons tried to cast out demons. The demons said, basically, Jesus we know and Paul we know. Who are you? And that's the basis of Scripture when Jesus said, depart from me, ye who work iniquity or lawlessness. I never know you. The question isn't so much, do you know Jesus? Does Jesus know you? Do you have a relationship with him? Because I can tell you this. Anybody who's ever had to experience any of the night terrors or being forced down or like you're, and I have gone through that too, by the way, the only thing I could do, even when I couldn't open my mouth, was to think, Jesus, help me, and rebuke him under my breath, and the thing left. And I want to share this with you, and I know that some people can't handle this, but I was on the phone. I think I told you about this, Tim. I was on the phone to Hawk one time, and I believe we were talking about something, and instantly the classic manifestation of the devil appeared to me with his horns and everything. He roared in the same voice that you were describing, that that kind of guttural anger, just total anguish, if you will, and contempt for humanity. And he said, and I don't even remember what I was talking to Hawk about, but the bottom line is, in real time, right before me, he rolls his head back, horns going towards the rear, and saying, you cannot stop me. Out of my innermost man rose a statement, I can't, but Jesus, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, can and has already. Well, the point being is a woman who is a caretaker at a place I had up in the mountains, she was praying multiple days before that, and the Lord told her to pray for Steve, and she said, Steve, does this mean anything to you? She came into my office, Tim, and listeners, after that, and says, does the Lion of the tribe of Judah mean anything to you? Well, needless to say, I had like an electrical storm of the confirmation of the Holy Ghost going through my body, and said yes, and I explained it to her. This is why it's so important we bear one another's burdens. This is why it's so important that we care and literally get involved in other people's lives and when we're anointed, not as busybodies. Look, as a sinner, I don't care about your sin. I care about the solution to sin. The sin is what kept you in Satan's power. The blood of Jesus is what breaks that power and brings you into the family of God. Where's the scripture for that? To as many as receive him, Jesus gave he the power to become the sons of God. There's nothing intellectual first and foremost about the power of God. Paul said, when I came to you, brethren, it wasn't with the enticing words of men's wisdom, but it was in the demonstration, the power, and the spirit thereof. In other words, talk is cheap. Well, hey, Doug, I think we're right up against the hour. Should we take a break and come back? And when we come back, ladies and gentlemen, we'll get into the Book of Giants, because it's something, by the way, you can get it free on my website. Go to Genesis, G-E-N-E-S-I-S, 6Giants, .com, and click on the manuscript part. And the point is, it's up in the nav bar. And when we talk about the Book of Giants, we're not talking about like a 365-page dissertation on giants. We're talking about fragments found written thousands of years ago, that just as there's the books of Enoch, and we only have basically fragments of a couple of them, the Book of Giants, the main part of the body of that is still missing, but we have enough of it to basically blow your minds. When we come back after the break, Tim is going to blow your mind with the Book of Giants, which will be the subject spelled out in great detail and researched to the infinite degree to basically share what's going on. So, Doug, can we take a break?
Phil and Tim Alberino, we are talking about fallen angels, demons, giants, as all hell is breaking loose on the earth. In the first hour, we got into the terminology and the difference between the words Nephilim, demons, fallen angels, and what those mean and why they're important. In this hour, we're going to turn it over to Tim, and he's going to get into some other important aspects on fallen angels and demons. And Tim, go ahead and take it away.
Well, we're going to talk about the Book of Giants here for a little bit, because it is exquisitely relevant to what we're been discussing. I've been studying the Book of Giants and writing about the Book of Giants and working with the Book of Giants for the last couple of weeks, because that's the next El Bueno analysis that's coming out in the next couple of days, is on the Book of Giants. So I'm going to give people a brief overview without getting into too much detail, because, again, it is so relevant to what we're talking about. Steve mentioned that the Book of Giants was found among the Dead Sea Scrolls, which are a collection of some 981 texts that were discovered between 1946 and 1956 in the caves of Qumran. They were discovered in caves on the cliffs of the Dead Sea, near the cliffs of the Dead Sea. That's why they're called the Dead Sea Scrolls. But anyways, the Dead Sea Scrolls, by the way, contain every single book in the Bible and in the Jewish and the Hebrew proto-canon, except for the Book of Esther. I don't know why the Book of Esther is excluded, but every other book of the Bible, and not just one copy, by the way, various copies of each book are present in the Dead Sea Scrolls. But besides that, also, a lot of the apocryphal works are also present in the Dead Sea Scrolls, including the Book of Jubilees, the Genesis Apocryphon, the Book of Noah, obviously the Book of Enoch, and the Book of Giants. By the way, all of those that I just mentioned, along with some other of the books from the Bible, were all found together in Cave 1 of Qumran, which I find interesting, because all of the ones I just mentioned, the Book of Jubilees, the Genesis Apocryphon, the Book of Noah, the Book of Enoch, and the Book of Giants, they all follow the same narrative, i.e. the Genesis 6 narrative, the Watchers and the Giants and the sexual or genetic corruption of all life on earth, and of course the flood. So the Book of Giants is probably follows the, in terms of the way it's written and the details of the story that's laid out in the Book of Giants. As Steve mentioned, it's fragmented, so, but there's enough there to really get a vivid picture of what's going on. But it's most similar to the Book of Enoch. And it seems to have been written based on the Book of Enoch. But the point is that the Book of Giants really spells out some things that that I have yet to find in some of these other apocryphal works, and that the Bible doesn't really identify the way that the Book of Giants does. And one of those things is something that is very provocative to me, and that's the idea that not only did these fallen angels, watchers as they're called in some of the old manuscripts, by the way, watcher is a specific classification amongst the angels. Remember I said the term angels is very general. Well, watchers is a specific order of angels. And by that term watcher, I don't remember exactly where it is in the Book of Daniel, but it's in the Book of Daniel. So it's not that people say, well, that term is extra-biblical. No, it's not. It is a biblical term, the term watcher. It is identifying a very specific kind of angelic being. And as Steve mentioned, there were 200 of these watchers that fell. That's the narrative of the Book of Enoch. That narrative is picked up in the Book of Giants. And like I was saying, there's a very provocative issue that the Book of Giants deals with, which is the idea that these watchers purposely and insidiously genetically contaminated the animals on the earth. And that's alluded to in the Book of Enoch, and it's alluded to in the Bible, but it is spelled out mathematically in the Book of Giants. Namely, the Book of Giants says that 200 donkeys, 200 asses, 200 rams of the flock, 200 goats, 200 beasts of the field, from every animal, from every bird, and there's some missing fragments here, so it's naming other animals that I'm not that we don't have in the text because they're missing. But all of these 200 of all the things I just mentioned were selected for miscegenation. And the word miscegenation means, it refers to the mixing of races or species, particularly in the context of sexual intercourse. So everybody just let that sink in for a minute. These watchers, these angelic beings, fallen angelic beings, purposely selected 200. They chose certain species of animals, including birds. I'm guessing that the missing fragments are also going to identify reptiles and fish and all other kind of all other species as well. But what we have here is a handful of animals that these watchers selected, and they selected 200 of each one. Why? Because there were 200 of them. There were 200 fallen watchers, and so they made sure that every single one of them, of the fallen watchers, would be able to inseminate each kind of species that was selected. Think about that. Think about how calculated and intentional this is, what they're doing. I mean, it is devious. It's absolutely maniacal. They're purposely trying to generate monsters. And that's exactly what happens. That's exactly what the result is. It says... So let me make this clear again. This term, miscegenation, is referring to the mixing of races and species, particularly in the context of sexual intercourse, which means they probably were having sex with these animals. And for people who have a problem with that, hey, listen, we barely understand the physics. We barely understand the physics that we're working with as the human race. There's no way that we could even begin to understand the physics that angels work with and that they understand. So making things bigger, smaller, transforming themselves into different shapes and different animals or whatever, that's all possible for these guys. So that answers the question of how. Now, these guys, these fallen angels, these watchers, they were not mixing species in terms of interspecies breeding like you would do with two dogs. We're talking about extreme cross-species genetics involving the seed of the angels themselves. We're not just talking about the angels taking, like I said, a donkey and let's say a bird or a goat and somehow getting them to copulate. That's not what we're talking about. The Book of Giants says, it spells out that these angels purposely selected these creatures so that they could insert their own seed into them. And it's unequivocal that it was their own seed, because the result is that these animals conceive monsters, not just monsters, sentient monsters. We're going to get to that in a minute. So here's another fragment from the Book of Giants explaining this. They defiled, they begot giants and monsters. Speaking of the fallen watchers, they begot, and behold, the whole earth was corrupted. Now, that word defiled is often used not only throughout the Old Testament and throughout the New Testament, but also in all these ancient manuscripts. It's often used specifically to describe sexual sin, that they were sexually defiling these animals and life on earth. And so it's important to note, and this is a really provocative part to me, it's important to note that not only were giants begotten of the fallen angels, but also monsters. And that is the term in the Book of Giants, monsters. Remember, not just one kind of monsters. We're talking about a litany of animals, a litany of animals and birds and probably reptiles and fish that they inserted their angelic seed into. And people are going to say, well, as Steve mentioned earlier, the what I think is the most lame argument in the world, well, angels, the Bible says angels don't marry. Who's talking about marriage? We're just talking about getting it on with whatever these guys could get their hands on. Nobody's talking about marriage. They didn't marry the animals. They just inseminated them. They're going around inseminating everything. Why? Everything that all life, basically. The Bible literally says all flesh was corrupted. So they're inseminating everything. And I want you to remember something, is that when if you take a goat, for example, and you do cross-species genetics on that goat, and if you do it properly, the creature that will come as a result, let's say of a goat and a pig, the creature that will come as a result, if you do it properly, will be able to procreate and will be able to then pass down those genes, those genetic markers, into their offspring. So it wasn't just that they just went out and chose a handful of animals. They wanted to screw around with them for sexual pleasure and to create, to progenerate monsters. They knew that by doing this, they would infect all life on the planet, because those monsters would then procreate and create more monsters. It's a domino effect. This was a very decisive, calculated thing. Okay, so they start to impregnate these animals. They start to inseminate these animals. These animals give birth to monsters. And the Book of Giants indicates that these monsters, because they had the seed of their fathers, the fallen angels, they were sentient. And here's a little fragment that proves that they were sentient. Thereupon, two of them had dreams, and the sleep of their eyes fled from them, and they arose and came to and told their dreams and said, and by the way, this is referring to the giants are having these dreams, and said in the assembly of their comrades, the comrades of the giants, the monsters. So the giants are only one kind of entity. And by the way, the Book of Enoch says that they all look different one from another. The giants were only one kind of entity, specifically part angel, part watcher, part human. So they were angel-human hybrids. The monsters are angel-animal hybrids, angel-bird hybrids, angel-reptile hybrids, angel-mammal hybrids. Okay, everything you can imagine, probably insects, who knows, everything you can imagine. These guys were intentionally defiling everything. And so you have these monsters. So these monsters were basically, they were the stepbrothers of the giants. They really were. They were stepbrothers and cousins of the giants. They had the same fathers. But they probably didn't have the same intellectual capacity of the giants, because the giants had human mothers, whereas the monsters had beasts for mothers. And so there's a hierarchy here that you can see that starts to develop. So just imagine 200 angels selecting a litany of species on the earth, and each one of them having intercourse or inseminating every one of those species that they selected. And then those divergent monsters procreating and probably mixing and matching among themselves. Are people starting to get the picture of what the days of Noah look like, of what the pre-flood world looked like? There is no mythology on the face of the planet that can even come close to describing what the scenario was, that can even come close. I mean, there were monsters and giants, and they were, and then it begins to say, it begins to describe, the Book of Giants begins to describe later on how they were terrorizing the earth. The giants and their brothers and their stepbrothers, the monsters, were terrorizing the earth, and they were consuming flesh, which was forbidden at that time, and they began to consume the human race as well, who was also becoming defiled. And the human race, by the way, the giants, and this is another thing that is indicated in the Book of Giants, the giants were the rulers of the earth. The giants were the ones who had the dominion, and obviously that makes a lot of sense, since they were probably way more intelligent than the human race, because they had the genetics of their fathers, the fallen angels, and the fallen angels taught them, the Book of Enoch says this, and the Book of Giants, the fallen angels, the fallen watchers, their fathers taught them, and not just them, but their wives as well, meaning the wives of the fallen angels, they taught them what's called the secrets of heaven. In both the Book of Giants and the Book of Enoch, refers to it as the secrets of heaven. Listen, we would refer to the secrets of heaven as advanced physics, mathematics, chemistry, astrology, etc. So the idea that the giants would be capable of not only be superior to us in intelligence, but would also be capable of manufacturing and operating advanced technology is certainly supported by the narrative that's laid out in the Bible, in the Book of Enoch, in the Book of Giants, and a host of other manuscripts, mythologies, as Steve mentioned. Every prime civilization on this planet, ancient civilization, had stories and mythology concerning the sons of God or the gods coming down and intermingling with men. Every single one of them. So this is verified. Not only is it verified in the Bible, it's verified in the apocryphal works, and it's verified in history. How much more proof do people need? Well, guess what? They're going to get it pretty soon, unfortunately for them. They're going to get it because these things are going to start to appear again. And whether or not the fallen angels start to inseminate all these animals again, regardless of whether they do this again or are doing it, regardless of that, we're doing it. We're doing it. We're doing the cross-species genetics now. We're opening Pandora's box. So even if people listening to this show right now don't have a spiritual paradigm for this, a biblical paradigm, understand that we're beginning to create, and we have been for years, create genetic aberrations. And there's going to be very scary consequences, and there already have been. So the Book of Giants really delineates some of this. And another interesting anecdote from the Book of Giants is that there's a reference made to at least one of the giants, specifically Quayle, who was the son of Barakel, the watcher Barakel, was able to fly. He had the ability of flight. And here's a little fragment from the Book of Giants explaining this. He mounted up in the air, meaning Quayle, and he was a giant, like strong winds, and flew with his hands like eagles. He left behind the inhabited world and passed over desolation, the great desert. He was on his way to visit Enoch, by the way, because the giants sought out Enoch to interpret their dreams, because they began to have dreams, and this is what the bulk of the Book of Giants is about. They began to have dreams about the flood, that there was impending judgment coming, and the dreams were really troubling them, and so they sought out Enoch to interpret the dreams. But my point here is that at least one of the giants, according to the Book of Giants, was able to fly. Now, and I make this point in my analysis, by the way. I break all this down in the analysis for people who want to know more about this. It's coming out in a couple of days. The giants, I mean, this could mean that he had the capability to fly. It could mean that he, because his father was Barakel, was a was a watcher, was a fallen angel, he might have genetically inherited something that allowed him, that gave him the innate capability of flight. Alternatively, this could be a reference, a rhetorical device that is making an allusion to technology, to aircraft. And, of course, anyone familiar with the ancient Sanskrit writings and the Vimanas and the flying machines and the legends about Solomon having a flying machine, there's many, many legends about flying machines from the ancient world. So this here could also be an indication that the giants were, in fact, using technology. I'm sure they were, because their fathers, the fallen angels, were teaching them all kinds of mysteries that are far superior to what we have today in terms of, like I said, in terms of mathematics and physics and astrology and so forth. So basically, I'll give everybody, again, this is going to be repeated in my analysis, so everybody can get this in the analysis. But I'm going to break down really quickly here, basically the chronological order of this in 2 minutes, and then I'll kick it back to Steve. This is what the Book of Giants breaks down. And remember, this is not just the Book of Giants. This corresponds and correlates perfectly with the Book of Enoch, with Genesis 6 and all the different mythologies and everything around the world. So this is basically the narrative of the Book of Giants. 200 angelic beings called watchers made a pact to defy God. They literally made a pact to defy God and descended to the earth in the days of Jared. They took human women as wives and had sexual intercourse with them. Their wives gave birth to hybrid giants. The watchers taught their wives and children the secrets of heaven, and the human race was beguiled by the forbidden knowledge. The giants began to rule over the inhabitants of the earth. The watchers chose animals from diverse species, 200 of each kind, in order to copulate with them and progenerate genetic aberrations. The animals conceived hybrid monsters according to their respective species. Nearly all life on the planet became genetically corrupted and flesh-eating or carnivorous. The giants and the monsters terrorized the earth and devoured the human race. The giants began to have foreboding dreams and visions that deeply troubled them. They decided to seek out Enoch to interpret the dreams. Enoch presents them with a copy of the tablet addressed to the watchers, pronouncing a terrible judgment from God upon them, their wives, and their children. The giants are in denial concerning their inevitable fate. The watchers come to the assembly of all their offspring and with great sorrow and weeping verify the terrible judgment written on the tablet. The giants, enticed by an angel of heaven, make war with one another and annihilate themselves. The watchers are bound by the angels of heaven and imprisoned in the abyss to the day of judgment. A great flood destroys all life on earth except Noah, his two sons, and their wives. Back to you, Steve.
What is important, ladies and gentlemen, by the way, all this is available on Genesis 6 Giants website, and up on the top nav bar, it's ancient manuscripts. You know, it's fascinating, the word monsters, because in the book of Esdras, I think Esdras, I don't know, chapter 2, verse 9 or somewhere around there, it says your women, and it's talking about the last days, Tim and Doug and Joe and everyone else listening, it's talking about your women will give birth to monsters. That word is interesting because when I first wrote Genetic Armageddon, I think, I don't know, 20 years ago or whenever, close to that, I put today's technology, tomorrow's monsters. When I actually did an update and took everything where it's at now, based on where we're seeing, I wrote the book Xenogenesis, and it's changing men into monsters. I don't think that it should be lost to anyone that the cannibalism, that the beheadings, all of the blood sacrifices taking place, these all were, how should I say this, represented in the religion of the Canaanites. Human sacrifice, cannibalism, beheading, disembowelment, tearing the hearts out, all of this was basically, and I'll be blunt, it's the religion of the fallen angels and their progeny, the giants. The giants basically began to eat. I mean, you know, Tim, it's amazing. We've got the word of the Lord in Joshua goes in to spy out the promised land in the book of Numbers, and he comes back and says, the land devours its inhabitants. The bottom line is that means they ate people. And when the giants, you know, the history associated with that time period says the people were slaves, and when the people couldn't produce enough, food for the giants, they just started munching on the, butlers, if you will. Also, it's fascinating to me that people don't know that there was actually a giant, a typical giant, that it could outrun chariots that was one of the Roman emperors. And I believe he had to eat, it was phenomenal, hundreds of pounds of meat and drink, 60 gallons of wine a day to keep him going. His name was you're going to love this, Maximinus, okay? And if you go on my website, stevequayle.com, or forgive me, not Steve Quayle, Genesis6Giants.com, go on the illustrations, you'll see the version of that Brian Snowdy did for me and how big that guy was. Now, what's fascinating is when we're talking about the whole genetic manipulation, and I'll take that for a few minutes, Tim, and then we'll really hit it in the next hour, but I want people to understand this, that nothing that I've written over the years was ever designed to scare, but to shine the light on. And it was always in the back of my mind that as this stuff was being written, and as I believe I was obedient to follow the direction of the Lord, it was to shed light almost as a time lock on a vault of information. And it's fascinating that even now, Tim, as Xenogenesis was written about, I think, a year ago, the point is that there's nothing now that is being hidden in the genetic manipulation of the human genome. Let me just read you just my introduction on the back of Xenogenesis, because I can't say it any better than I've already written it. I'm not saying whoopee, I'm just saying can't do it. A future of unimaginable horrors created for our planet by unseen masters. Xenogenesis reveals a future of terror that will soon face human beings. Monstrous creations are being developed with secret technology in labs around the world. Xenogenesis is the production of an offspring entirely different from either of the parents, transformed through the addition of DNA from an alien or animal to the normal genetics of a human being. The results will be comic book superheroes come to life, living creatures with mythical abilities unlike anything mankind has seen for thousands of years, and with inspired the ancient legends of gods and goddesses. This horrifying future targets God's original creation for corruption. Evil forces hope to use fallen angel technology to shift the balance of power from God and mankind to Satan and his followers. Monsters will soon be presented as our saviors, with hollow promises of eternal life without the need of God or morality. Even now, these seducing spirits are guiding and tricking mankind to unwittingly commit genetic suicide. The replacement race stands poised to bring about the total annihilation of the human race. This book offers hope. There is a way to avoid the dangers and ultimately save mankind from this hell on earth that evil powers have devised. There is a true Savior, Jesus, who waits silently and patiently to rescue human beings from this most perilous time in history. And this book will reveal how you and your loved ones can find the way to avoid the dangers on our planet we now face, okay? So we're in a position now to experience this stuff. I don't believe God wastes any effort. I don't believe the Lord is in any way trying to scare his creation, but when we have not been given the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind literally means that mind, and I believe that God really is so clear in his words. You know, Paul chose the words, a sound mind is we listen to the voice of God. Jesus said, he's a good shepherd, his sheep hear his voice. And that people have to have the understanding of the words we're talking about. We're talking about artificial intelligence, when we're talking about singularity, when we're talking about the things that the end of humanity, the conspiracy to destroy, when we're talking about creating sex bots. I remember Tim talking about that, and oh boy, did the flack come flying from the religious people. Yet, Tom Horton made a statement. He says, I'm worried, Steve, that the church and modern Christendom does not have any understanding that is of those things, I think, which are going to overtake them. And I agree with Tom on that. So, ladies and gentlemen, when, again, Genesis 6 Giants lays it out for you, And for those of you that don't understand what Tim was talking about, the Vimanas and the Vedic, V-E-D-I-C texts of ancient Sanskrit and ancient India, if you understood the Rama Empire, now these are important. This is not to take away from the Word of God. It's just to underscore the relevance of the Word of God. I tell people, Tim, and I stand by this statement, if you dismiss Genesis 6, you absolutely dismiss the foundation of understanding the explosion of wisdom, architecture, science, and everything else. You see, that's the knowledge of good and evil. And men, even those who hate God and absolutely are doing everything to deny the name of Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if you saw it today, but every news story that's carried, it absolutely becomes more and more, in our faces as Christians, that there is a supernatural intelligence guiding the mainstream media, guiding the policies of the financial community, the medical community, the philosophical community, rewriting history, and the whole thing that the enemy of men's souls, the devil, is doing is to destroy our history, to destroy our heritage, and to break our relationship dependency, and to get us to lose hope by taking our eyes off Jesus and putting it on everything else. Now look, and I want to make this clear. Talk radio, 23 years. Even one of my critics the other day made a statement. He said, well, at least you've been consistent. The point being is this. The central thread of truth is like a scarlet weave. It's like Rahab's robe that was let down to let Joshua and the spies, the crimson rope, and I believe that's a type of the blood of Jesus, that because of her faith, didn't matter that she was a prostitute at that time. What mattered is she believed that God was with Joshua. And she made Joshua and the men promise that the spies that Joshua sent in promised that they would not destroy her when the city fell. She knew the city was going to fall. She knew what she was doing. And by the way, my guess is she was pretty prominent in the city, because it doesn't sound like she was, the run-of-the-mill streetwalker. I'm sorry to be so blunt, but the point being, she believed God. And what people have a hard time with, especially religious people, is in these last days, God is going to raise up a people who respond to his mercy, his forgiveness, his love, his power, and they're going to look not to themselves, whether they're in the guttermost or the uttermost, they're going to look to the King of Glory. I talked to Henry Gruber last night on the phone, and for the record, Lord willing, Doug's agreed to this. He'll be on Friday night. And Henry's stories that he's talking about of what happened, he was in Asia for the last 90 days in some of the most dangerous places in the world, and yet God preserved him. Now, God bless Henry. There are very few Henrys. As a matter of fact, I only know one Henry Gruber in the earth, and his name is Henry Gruber. But he said an interesting thing. And he was talking about why God hasn't moved. I mean, he was touched, and I'll let him tell his own story, but he was touched with a certain group of people that were singing beautiful worship to not the God of heaven, but to the statue of Buddha. And when he asked the Lord, this is critical to what we're talking about tonight, Tim, why those people, why will the Lord not bring him them? I believe he's in Taiwan. Why would he not save those people who people have prayed for? And the Lord said this, because I do not have enough shepherds that can care for the lambs. I will raise up the shepherds, and when I do, I will bring them in as the lambs to my salvation. Well, I shared that with Pastor Langford today, and he said, wow, that's God. And it gave me goosebumps because I understand it. We're speaking, Tim, tonight to people all over the world. I just got an email from Bogota, Colombia, actually Medellin, the home of the infamous Medellin cartel, and Christians all over. What's astonishing to me, they've been asking, Lord, show me how it all fits together. The Pentagon refers to the Sumerian gods and the Anunnaki. Anunnaki are just those who descend from Anu. The bottom line in all this, and this is what is astonishing to me, there are people who are on late-night talk radio that believe we are crazy Christians, yet they will not accept the idea that God, but they won't ask the most important question of their bias, and I would call their intellectual one-way rail car over the cliff, and that's who made the aliens. By the way, the book of Daniel even talks about an alien god. So what we're talking about tonight is the very foundational revelation of God of the end times, men's hearts failing them for looking after those things coming upon the earth. In the book of Joel, Doug Hagman included it in his write-up, I think it's Joel 3, 9, and 11, it talks about the mighty coming up from under the earth and the mighty coming down from the heaven. Well, that interesting word is basically based on the scriptural term for supernatural entities. It's not talking about, you know, some guy who's been at a Gold's Gym for the last 20 years. It's talking about supernatural. It's interesting. Guess what, ladies and gentlemen? Consider this. We are going to be put into the ultimate squeeze. The powers of heaven are going to shake. The war in heaven is going to take place, and Michael and his angels are going to boot the devil and his angels out of the realm that they still occupy into the heavens. And the cry is, woe unto you, inhabitants of the earth. Dimitri Dudeman gets a visitation from the angel of the Lord. He had many of them, and before he passed on to go to be with the Lord, the angel told him, the mind of man cannot even begin to conceive. The book of Joel, talking about God's end-time army that he releases on the earth, if people understood, Tim, that even our own Defense Department and the powers of the Illuminati and elite believe that the very angel technology that they have been given, that they bargained their souls with, they believe they can defeat God, I would remind everybody that they're making stuff out of that which God spoke into existence. In Latin, it's, I believe it's ex nihilo, out of nothing. And he who calls everything out of nothing, and God said, let there be light. Those who want to take the light and try and put it into a super laser, a super this weapon, a super that weapon, I would recommend and remind everybody that, guess what? They didn't succeed the first time. So what Tim has laid out in the Book of Giants will be on the Alberino analysis, and so all this is critical. It's called destroy the entire human race. Jesus said if the days weren't shortened, there'd be no flesh left alive. If you understand singularity, if you understand the merging of men and machines, if you understand homo noeticus, if you understand, and I call it homo satanicus, the bottom line is, in other words, Satan is offering to the people that serve him all the money in the world. That's why Jesus said, the love of money is the root of all evil. And look at what they have done versus what the church has done. What the church has done, they've built monuments to themselves. They've built, in my opinion, whited sepulchers filled with dead men's bones. And listen, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. If you are in a church, I don't even know why I'm going here now, and you do not get the word of the Lord, then you are in a mausoleum. Get out of there. Come forth as Lazarus. Come forth as Lazarus. Get unbound by the people that have the ministry and deliverance. Set your heart and your affections on learning the word of God and see just what it is, an incredible walk with Jesus that he offers you. Go ahead, Tim.
You know, it's interesting. You were mentioning the angelic technology in the pre-flood times. You know, I learned so much from doing the analysis on Pember's Earth's Earliest Ages. Something that he highlights, it really brought everything into perspective for me, because we live in a technological time, and people are confused by the technology. People are confused because it seems so separated. It seems so different than the biblical times. But that's because really the times in which we live are a lot more like the pre-flood days than they were like Abraham's time, or you know, or Moses or the apostles. So we're literally going full circle. And the interesting thing that Pember points out is that after the Adam and Eve were expelled from the Garden of Eden, they were laboring in the earth. They had to labor. Remember, it says by the sweat of their brow to bring forth the produce of the earth. And they would sow, let's say they would sow wheat, and thistles and thorns would pop up. That was the curse of the earth. That's the human condition, by the way. It's sin and death is really what our condition is. That's what Jesus rectified on the cross, with sin and death and separation from God in himself. And so, anyways, so that was the condition of the earth in the antediluvian world. It was a terrible situation, and the righteous, this is what Pember points out, I never thought of it this way, but it was so astute of George Pember to point this out. The righteous were toiling and working with the earth by the sweat of their brow, putting their hope and trust in the salvation that was to come. They were not trying to ascend. They were not trying to rectify their own condition by the power of their own intellect and by the might of their own hands. That's what the seed of Cain was doing. That's what the people who were following the fallen angels were doing. That's what the giants were leading people into. But Enoch and the line of Seth and the righteous were waiting. They were toiling. They understood that this was a condition of sin and death, and they were looking forward to the hope of their salvation. They were looking forward to the mercy of God. Now, the times in which we live right now are the antithesis to that. People, we talk about the singularity, we talk about transhumanism. It's all about ascending our condition. It's all about, by the might of our intellect, by the power of our intellect, by the might of our hands, ascending our condition, overcoming the condition of sin and death. And what a foolish thought that is. And that's really what the thrust of all this is. We need to break these bonds, this curse of sin and death, because everybody, sin and death is at work in all of our bodies. It's at work in the earth. The reason why there is contention in nature has nothing to do with Darwinism. Nothing. It has nothing to do with evolution. Nothing. Contention in nature is man's fault. It's not God's fault, and it's not a function of evolution. Contention in nature, when I say contention, I mean animals eating animals. The struggle for life is a result of sin and death. And it is a condition, and guess what? It's a condition that the Son of God has rectified in us on the cross, because we're going to be resurrected into new bodies and into new life, everlasting. And it's a condition that's going to be rectified on the earth, because he remakes everything and makes it new. So the whole earth is groaning and waiting for that to happen, because the earth is burdened with our condition. The whole earth is burdened with the human condition. We're not burdened with the condition of nature. Do you see how Darwinism and evolution flip that upside down? We're not burdened with the condition of nature. We're not burdened with the struggle of life and death. All of nature is struggling and laboring under our condition. So back to the antediluvian times, the righteous ones, the ones who were sitting under the teaching of Enoch and Adam, and remember, a lot of these guys were contemporaries because they lived so long, and Noah and Methuselah, the righteous, the assembly of the righteous, they were looking forward to the hope of salvation. They were looking forward to the mercy of God. They knew that God would rectify things because God was faithful. They loved him and they knew him. But at the same time, the giants were wreaking havoc. At the same time, the sons of men were going after being beguiled by the technology, and it was high technology. It wasn't just technology that involved sticks and stones. It was high technology. It was technology the likes of which we haven't even reached yet in our times. And they're all going and being beguiled after the secrets of heaven that these fallen angels were divulging to their sons and their wives and to the human race. And this is something that Pember writes. I'm going to read this paragraph here, and it really nailed me because it's so powerful. But let this sink in. It really hits you hard if you get it. Remember, the righteous were laboring with the cursed earth. And everybody else was too, by the way, but the righteous were waiting for the hope of salvation. They knew that the rectification of sin and death was coming at some point. I don't know if they knew the details, but they knew it was coming at some point, that God was going to have mercy. I don't know if they knew that he was going to send his only begotten son. I don't know, but I know that the hope of salvation was in them. They understood the mercy and the long-suffering of God. And Methuselah, by the way, is testimony that he's the longest living person in the Bible, and his name means his death shall bring, and the flood didn't come until he died, and that is a testimony to the mercy of God. So this is what Pember writes. fit objects, then, are the thorn and the thistle to remind man of the curse. And keeping their origin in view, we can see a deep significance in that awful scene when our Lord suffered himself to be crowned with thorns, so that even his enemies set him forth as the great curse bearer. When he wore on his bleeding brow that which owed its very existence to and was the sign of the sin which he had come to expiate. I mean, isn't that powerful? What a beautiful way that Pember put that. And think about that. Jesus, and it never occurred to me, Steve, Doug, Joe, that the crown of thorns that Jesus wore on his head was literally the symbolism of the sin and death that was cursed, cursing the whole earth, and that was cursed, that humanity was cursed with. Here he was, the rectification of that very sin and death that he had no part in. He never sinned. It wasn't him, but yet it was laid on him and pressed into his skull. And they ripped his beard from his face and bit him and whipped him. He, the Son of God, the singularity himself, the author of life himself, came, took on our condition, bore that sin and death, and crucified it. Crucified it in himself so that we could be rectified to the Father and live in everlasting bliss with the Lord. I mean, think about that. That's what's happening now, by the way, is this transhumanism, this thrust towards ascending our condition. They literally use, by the way, that very terminology. The transhumanists and the futurists, their moral banner is we want to mix the genes and we want to and create the robots and the singularity, everything that Steve's book Xenogenesis details. Everything that they're trying to do, their moral banner is to improve the human condition. That's their moral banner. You're going to hear it over and over and over. Those aren't my words. Those are theirs. This is to improve the human condition. That's why we need to merge ourselves with machines. That's why we need to genetically upgrade ourselves. It's to improve the human condition. But there is no salvation in improving the human condition, only in the singular rectification of the human condition, and that's the cross of Jesus Christ. So these guys—that's the Luciferian narrative. They're toiling. They're using their own strength and wisdom and intelligence to try and break themselves free from the curse of sin and death. And it's worse. They're using angel technology at this point to do it. They're deriving their technology. Remember, I referred to earlier that the UFOs are not Nephilim, that's actual hardware. It is actual hardware. And guess what? It's been given to our governments. They've literally gotten in bed with the devil in order to get this technology. Just as Steve said, all the nations are selling them their souls to this right now. And so what is going to happen? And it is inevitable, absolutely inevitable, that the future of this planet is going to look like the days of Noah, literally, because the genetic aberrations are coming and nobody can stop it. We're going to go full circle with this whole thing, and that's why it is so critical to understand it.
One of the things that's important, ladies and gentlemen, is that you have a background and understanding in this. When Genesis 6 Giants, the book that I wrote, I don't know how many years ago, forgive me, I'm not trying to be, not exactly, I just don't remember. I think, Tim, you read it years ago. Master Builders of Prehistoric and Ancient Civilizations. That book has touched more people around the world for the truth. Now, here's the thing that people don't understand. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, these things are available on my website, Steve Quayle, and it's important. Somebody says, quit giving an advertisement for your books. When I am tasked with carrying out the introduction, if you had a tooth and you needed it fixed, you go to a dentist. If you're going to deal with a war of which you have very little understanding, you need to know how it's played. I can't teach you actual war tales. I'm not a soldier. I haven't been in the war. But I can teach you. The scripture says, freely I have received, I give. And here it is. the creation. And in Genesis 6 Giants, Tim, the very cover, and pretty soon, by the way, Tim's designed, I don't know if you people know this, he's a graphic artist, but one of the things we're going to do is give this, put this out on a T-shirt form with the actual cover of the book, and he's done a really great job. And why? Because it blows people blows people's minds when they see giants. It's fascinating. One of the most amazing phenomena in the United States and worldwide was when Michael Crichton wrote the book Jurassic Park. And obviously Spielberg made the first one or two movies, the first one for sure, and then, you know, it was a franchise. I think they made three of them. But in Genesis 6 Giants, and I don't know how many footnotes are on that. The point being is there are so many that I had to divide it up into two parts. I deal with creation, pre-Adamic Earth. Tim was just quoting Pember, Earth's Earliest Ages, one of the most important books ever written. The destruction of angelic civilizations. I gave out on the radio the other night that you can download the Biblical Flood and Ice Epic by Donald Patton, P-A-T-T-E-N, free. And he had a great book. I don't think it's on the internet for downloading, but it's basically Biblical Catastrophism. Catastrophes in the Old Testament and in the New are always linked with judgment. When Vesuvius blew up, and by the way, Vesuvius was interesting. If any of you have ever been to that part of Italy and seen the devastation, it's pretty amazing. And when you see the sexual connotations in Vesuvius were so apparent. And again, let's just talk about this, Tim, because I think it's important. When you understand that modern architecture, for instance, the Washington Monument, the obelisk at St. Peter's Square, all obelisks are, if you will, a neon sign to the fallen angels having penetrated, which is one of the words that is, one of the definitions of Nephal, N-I-P-H-A-L, which is a derivation of Nephal, or from which we get Nephilim. And when you see all of the different menhirs and dolmens, those are the different stones like Stonehenge and Karnak and all this stuff, all this stuff has one connotation. I'll be blunt. It's all sexual. So in part one of Genesis 6 Giants, creation, pre-Adamic Earth, the destruction of the angelic civilizations. You know, Tim, most people have a hard time understanding that in the book of Jeremiah, there's a literal flood before Adam's flood. God judged the angelic civilization. When you come into Tohu and Bohu, when you come into the recreation, the replenishing in the first two verses of Genesis, something awful had happened in order to bring that upon them. How about this, ladies and gentlemen? Believe it or not, the religion of the giants. And the point being is that there are giants in the world, giants in Europe, giants all over the place. And I think, Tim, I'm pretty sure because I was contacted by either the History Channel or another, I don't know which one, National Geographic History, and there's one other one, Discovery Channel. They're all now becoming interested in giants. As I said before, I didn't finish my thought, but I will. Michael Crichton, when he wrote Jurassic Park, brought a whole new interest to dinosaurs. Literally, so few of people have dealt with Leviathan in the Bible and Behemoth, B-E-H-E-M-O-T-H, the great sea serpent that God himself said he slew, the dragons in history. All this stuff is not just based on, you know, comic book heroes from the area or the era of 4000 BC, okay? The point being is that they're dealing with the genetic manipulations. They're dealing with monsters from antiquity. Most people don't even know that the words satyr, S-A-T-Y-R, and unicorn are in the Bible. And those don't mean, you know, some fuzzy little insect, and they don't mean some strange bird. You know, it is, the Bible is clear. It is not totally definitive because God has sealed up the vision. He literally told the prophet Daniel that some things would be revealed only as they were ready to happen. Seal it up, Daniel, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, for knowledge shall run to and fro. And the time of the end. I believe, ladies and gentlemen, what you're hearing tonight are the very revelations that Daniel, much of it that Daniel was presented, but it was sealed up until the appropriate time. So I would encourage you to take a look at Genesis 6 Giants, the book I've written. Tim, I'm not asking you for a book report, but did that book put a lot of stuff into perspective for you?
Genesis 6 Giants was really an introduction into the paradigm of the Watchers, the Giants, and everything, all the genetic stuff for me. It really was. In fact, when I was looking around in the beginning, when I was in Peru, really digging into this stuff, by the way, because I was hearing stories of giants in Peru, and I never really looked into it. I knew about the Nephilim and everything like that, but I never really delved into it until I started to get these reports. I remember sitting with a good friend of mine. His father is a hunter, sitting out in his what's called a chakra, his farm, in a thatched roof tambo, in a thatched roof hut. And I can see him now swinging there in his hammock, telling me stories about going days into the jungle hunting. And the real hunters, these old Peruvian guys, the real hunters go by themselves. And they go days into the jungle, and he was telling me one time how he was days into the jungle, and he saw these giants. They were giant human-like beings, and it was like there was a tribe of them way out there. And they didn't want to be seen, and they were eluding him, and this wasn't a dream. This was, real time. And so that really piqued my interest, and I began to dive in, and of course I came across Steve's work, and then I got a copy of Genesis 6 Giants, and that just lit the fire. So, yes, it absolutely ignited me.
And, ladies and gentlemen, the book Xenogenesis, too, why I'm saying this is that I'm concerned, at the minute Ebola, whatever the crisis or the manufactured crisis is, people won't get this knowledge. And what I love is the fact that Genesis 6 Giants has gone worldwide. Aliens and Fallen Angels, the Sexual Corruption of the Human Race. That book, I've had more response from atheists and non-believers and scientists that book put into perspective. The reason God told the children of Israel to go into the land of the Canaanites and destroy every man, woman, and child is because they were hybrids. And had Israel not done that, and they failed to do it, but when they obeyed God, they were blessed. When they disobeyed God, it wasn't God, was a meanie. I can't tell you how many people have had aught in their heart against the Lord, and once they understand that these were not human beings but hybrid entities, that had not God told the children of Israel to destroy them, they wouldn't be alive. You want to know what the bottom line is in the Middle East, everybody? It's not the Palestinian issue. It's not this. It's payback, and they are torqued. They are angry. And the Philistines are the Palestinians of today, and so many of these genetic memories that are out there, they go back. They want payback, and this is why the entities that control Jerusalem, this is why the supernatural power of hell that is vying for Jerusalem literally wants to wipe out the seed of the promises that God gave to Abraham, to his seed, and the redemption that he holds, because they want payback. And as an Illuminati guy told me, Doug, and Joe and Tim, he says, and payback's going to be a bitch. That's his words, I quote, unquote. I think we better take the break right now, and we'll come back. And when we come back, we'll let you know of the militarization of this aspect. Some of you have heard Tim talk about super soldiers, but it goes way beyond that. Go ahead, Joe. Are you handling it?
Yeah, we're going to go to the top of the hour break now. And that hour was fantastic, laying some great foundational information, biblical foundational information on the entities of darkness that we are fighting against and have been fighting against since the fall of man into today. And when we come back, we'll get into the last hour of the show with Steve Quayle and Tim Alberino. You can find Tim Alberino, the Alberino analysis, on Steve Quayle's site, stevequayle.com. Stay with us for the last hour. We'll be right back after these short messages.
Hi, ladies and gentlemen. Doug Hagman here for American Survival Wholesale Products. That's AmericanSurvivalWholesale.com. They are our partners in this radio endeavor. They're it's a Christian-owned company. It's a veteran-owned company. There are good friends. They are our partners. They've done so much for us, and I know so much for so many of you. I don't know if I'm supposed to say this. This could be a very super secret thing. I don't know. I'll just blame it on my mental cloudiness. But word has it that in the very short term, very shortly, that American Survival Wholesale will be offering one of their largest
GMO-free Thrive sales ever. Keep your eyes open. It will be upcoming very shortly. Their largest GMO-free Thrive sales ever, and this is due to the rising prices in food, and they're doing this so people can lock in their long-term food storage prices before the prices go sky high. Once again, the largest GMO-free Thrive sale ever will be coming up very soon.
And that's fantastic, Joe. Thanks for bailing me out. Also, folks, right now,
during the times in which we are warned about in Bible prophecy, as both Steve and Tim have done a tremendous job of breaking down the intricacies of the dark demonic forces behind what we see manifesting in our world today. And before we get into the third hour, I'm going to turn it over to my father. He wants to say something.
I just want to thank, I don't know who to thank, but I've received a package today, and it was something that was very important, very meaningful to me, and I just want to say thank you. It was glass. There was no card in it. It was constructed of glass, and also had two images on it to the sender of that. God bless you. Thank you so very much. You actually brought a tear to my eye today, more than one tear, actually. I just wanted to say thank you. I don't know who you are, but may God bless you. And if you want to send me an email, I'd like to personally thank you. But with that, go ahead, Joe.
All right, I'm going to turn it back over to Steve in this third hour, and go ahead and get into what we're going to get into.
Well, I think it's important, again, probably one of the most important parts, and ladies and gentlemen, all this stuff is free. If you go to my website, I have another website besides my main one. It's called Genesis6Giants.com. And up on the top, below all the ancient manuscripts, you'll see ancient text. And there you'll find the Epic of Gilgamesh, amazing stuff, the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Book of Giants, what Tim was talking about, the Book of Enoch, the Forgotten Books of Eden, which are amazing. One of the things that always bothered me, Tim, and, I couldn't imagine what it would be like to be Adam, having the intelligence of Adam. And he didn't need to go to school. God gave him a supernatural understanding. Talk about someone. And I always wondered, Adam, what did Adam know? I mean, having known God, having walked in the garden, we don't know every bit of timing involved in it. And yet to have the full understanding of all that God had given to him when God gave him, placed him in the garden and dominion, yet to have the understanding that you had totally sold out the future of that which God would bring from your loins. It blew my mind. Well, I basically, came to understand through the ancient books. Now, look, I want to make it clear. Neither Tim or I put this on the same level as Scripture, okay? We're not saying this has it, but we're saying that there's so much in antiquity. And by the way, if you don't think this is important, Tim, I was told by a certain general, actually a couple of them, that the control of the books of Enoch, for the record, there's 360 of them. We have fragments of two, are in the total possession of the Illuminati. Those of you who have read my book, The Long Walkers, the fictional novel, if you go to the very back, you're going to see a ceremony that took place under the streets of Rome. You think that's all make-believe? That was drawn by Brian Snoddy at the most, by an artist who is a military man that literally took the Book of Enoch that's controlling the giant. Now, for the record, on my alerts, I was contacted by a brother in another country who's one of the foremost Chaldean, I've heard some people pronounce it Chaldean, That's for where Abraham came out of Ur of the Chaldees to translate a ancient manuscript that will allow the people that are trying to bring back Nimrod, literally reconstitute him, and that will allow the reconstituted Nimrod to come back on the scene and control him. I said, good luck with that, because it isn't going to happen. But if you remember the story of Nimrod, his body was cut up into different pieces and sent to all the different parts of the world. Nimrod was a very evil entity. So when my brother in the Lord contacted me and gave me that information, my mind was blown. This is what most people can't understand, which will get us into the super soldiers. When the Human Genome Project was first undertaken a decade or so ago, the point of it wasn't to understand just how human DNA worked. It was that too, but it was looking for genetic markers. Ladies and gentlemen, if you wonder why the Christians and true Jews and others are being marked for extinction, let me make it simple. Anybody that is of their father, the devil, and that's what Jesus, basically called certain Pharisees and Sadducees, you have your father, the devil, he's dealing with the bloodlines. And these guys who have all the money in the world, because they just print as much as they need, have spent trillions with a T to ascertain the different gene and genomes of the fallen ones in antiquity. Now, why is this important? Because the idea that Satan is going to reproduce a entity in his image and likeness, can you imagine how wonderful that's going to be looking like? And by the way, in my book Xenogenesis, the scientists I quote in there are talking about making some of the most gross creatures with multiple appendages and multiple orifices, and it's astonishing to me, and as I was doing the research, that the driving force, Tim, in even robotics and artificial intelligence and sex bots is still the predominant theme driving the money that's being put into this. What I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen, is it's Blade Runner on steroids. Blade Runner was one of the first movies to really take this on, the idea of robots and sentient robots. And when they achieve true AR, artificial intelligence. And so, ladies and gentlemen, where we're at right now, and I'm going to turn it over to Tim, and he can turn it back, is we've got the idea out there already that there are creatures that have been produced for the perverted appetites of those things that are coming up on the earth. I've said it so many times, I hate to reiterate it, but probably one of the most forethoughtful episodes ever filmed in the Twilight Zone series was to serve man. I wish I could get across. I know Romy has had a vision. I posted on my Dreams and Vision years ago of literally angels descending, black angels from descending, and it had nothing to do with, quote, the color of their skin, but they were dark. In other words, they were evil angels descending from heaven with a beautiful melodic singing. And the people, and they would go behind this, I think it was a building, and if I'm wrong, Romy, I'm doing this from memory, and the people would run to them. They were captivated by them. And the Lord showed Romy that these entities were eating the people, running to them, being lured by the siren song, okay? In the last 2 weeks, if you watch my alerts, the nature of the supernatural is becoming more and more prominent. I had one from a military guy. I put it up, and he literally watched the whole preparation of human beings being prepared for demonic habitation. Go to my website, stevequayle.com, and then only to be basically eaten up by these entities that feigned looking one way and became another. In the book of Adam and Eve, it literally talks about, this is on my website again, that Satan faked to be a beautiful woman in order to try and lure Adam. And God interrupts that and strips Satan of his projected image. In other words, the way the devil is, he really looks, is based on his nature, his fallen nature. But he can cloak and hide his true identity. Just, and I just had an email from a Native American asking me, how do skinwalkers fit into this? Skinwalkers are not demons. They are fallen angels. They mute themselves or transform themselves into different entities. A demon typically has to possess an existing animal, an existing person, or an existing inanimate object, i.e. a stone idol or whatever. So skinwalkers, and by the way, deal with that. And probably the other thing I got to share with you, if you understand that legends aren't, you know, peyote ceremonies gone awry or somebody stoned on mushrooms, but the correlation between all the different legends of all the different civilizations are all tied to that central truth of multidimensional creatures intervening and intermingling with the human race. So what we're seeing now is we're seeing super soldiers being built, literally genetically altered, and being attenuated with everything from night vision built into their eyes by chlorophyll. They're being absolutely given the strength, and I'm not talking about exoskeletons, I'm talking on a genetic level. I think it was in, which book did I write about it now? I wrote in one of my books, Genetic Armageddon, about human growth factor and what's called the Herculean gene. And it's got a typical code on it, but, you know, and I talked about a little girl in Romania that could lift like 10 times her body weight, and she's a scrawny little thing, but they did a genetic test on her. So imagine this. Imagine the supernatural strength. By the way, one of the ways the Catholic Church, I'm not endorsing this, I'm just telling you this, decides whether a person is truly demon-possessed or not, if they have supernatural strength beyond an ordinary man. That they have three criteria, and that's one of them. The other one is they have to speak in a language they don't know, and obviously when you're dealing with entities that are thousands of years old, and I've literally seen that with my own eyes, and I forget the other thing, but what we're talking about is that now that the desire to build a super soldier, and what happens, ladies and gentlemen, when robots, here you go, get demon-possessed, or demon, if you will, articulated, and what happens to the human race? Everything is designed to make war on God and the saints. They can't prevail, but this is what you must know. Go ahead, Tim. However you want to, you know, interplay into that thought, be my guest.
Yeah, I like to, you mentioned sirens, that those angels were like sirens coming down, enticing men. What sprang to mind was there's an interesting detail in the Book of Enoch that a lot of people overlook, is that obviously the watchers were judged severely, the fallen angels. They were bound and put into the abyss. The sons of the watchers, the giants, were destroyed. They killed each other. And then, of course, they became the disembodied spirits. But many people overlook what happened to the wives of the watchers, which indicates that the wives were not just innocent victims, but they were very much a part of the wickedness that was going on. The wives, God literally turned them into sirens, according to the Book of Enoch, which is very interesting to me because they were part of the ones that were enticing men to worship their husbands, the fallen angels, the watchers. They were the ones that were proliferating the forbidden knowledge and the watchers, obviously. They became basically these women under the instruction of the watchers. They became seducing women. They became very Jezebel-like, seductive women. And so, interestingly enough, their judgment was God turned them into sirens, which I find very interesting, and people could extrapolate on that. And there's a lot that could be said. But going to this issue of super soldiers, you know, I have three examples I want to give people here about super soldier technology that will put this into perspective for you, so that you understand that this isn't theoretical. The idea of super soldiers is well underway. The manufacturing of super soldiers is well underway, and I have a couple of articles here that I printed out the other day from this year, from 2014. One, I think they're both in the spring of this year. And the first one is a article entitled DARPA's Elect RX Project, Self-Healing Bodies Through Targeted Stimulation of the Nerves. Basically, what this project that DARPA's already undertaking is geared towards is to control the nervous system. It's also to be able to give human beings the ability to self-generate. And it uses chips. Right now it's functioning basically off of chips. Its aim is to develop new high precision, minimally invasive technologies for modulating nerve circuits to restore and maintain human health. And this is, I'm reading from the article. Put it simply, the idea is to implant into people's bodies ultra-miniaturized devices that could hook into the brain and modulate the peripheral nervous system's response to infections, injuries, or imbalances. That all sounds nice, you know, for people who have severe disabilities or whatever. But if they can modulate, if they can, through these chips, if they can modulate the peripheral nervous system's response to infections and so forth, couldn't they also then manipulate the nervous system as a whole? And if you manipulate the nervous system, you can, together with MK Ultra mind control and Luciferian programming, you can literally take somebody over. You know, it's one thing to build a robot. That's scary in and of itself. It's another thing to turn the human body into a robot. In other words, be able to interface with somebody's body, control not only their mind, but also control their nervous system. And this is already underway. They're going to achieve this. There's enough money behind this stuff. They're going to achieve it. It's not a question of if. It's only a question of when. And isn't it interesting that DARPA goes funding these things and begins to work on these things, and they kind of fly under the radar. There's techies out there that keep track of this stuff, but the general public's just, they got their, you know, they got their eyes glued to their Facebook accounts. They don't realize that this stuff is years in development already, a lot of it. And this particular project has just begun. But with the kind of money that the Pentagon is throwing behind this stuff, you can be assured that this will end up surfacing in the next 5 years. And here's the reason why, by the way, before I get into these other two examples. The main reason why it's inevitable is because China's doing it, is because Russia's doing it, is because some of the other nations are doing it. It's an arms race. It's a race. And it's only logical that if we want to compete on the battlefield, we have to make sure that our technology is relevant and is going to be able to match or outmatch what the Chinese are fielding in the future. So understand, it's inevitable. It's a proverbial slippery slope. And so that's going to happen. If they can't already do it, they're going to be able to control people's nervous systems with chips. Here's another one. This is from MIT Technical Review. Military funds brain-computer interfaces to control feelings. They're really interested. Isn't it kind of creepy to everybody how interested the military is and has been historically on controlling people's minds? I mean, all the clandestine programs that they've executed in the past, you know, I mentioned MKUltra and Monarch and all the different programs, not to mention all the Luciferian programs that the secret societies have perfected. They're so interested in controlling people's minds. And as I mentioned, people being glued to Facebook, one of the first things that's necessary to control somebody's mind is to distract their mind or to empty their mind. That's why transcendental meditation is so dangerous, because when you put yourself on that level and when you become distracted to such a degree that you're absolutely distracted with video games or with Facebook or with TV, they can then come in the back door and subliminally begin to control the way you're thinking. And that's absolute fact. That's not conspiracy. My God. They admit that they can do this in so many different books and articles, and I mean hundreds and hundreds have been written on that. But this one here is particularly, this MIT Technological Review here is particularly disturbing because the subheading is a $70 million program will try to develop brain implants able to regulate emotions and the mentally ill. If that doesn't creep you out, that creeps me out big time. I mean, they want to try and regulate the emotions, the emotions of the mentally ill. Guess who's on top of that list? The veterans. Right on top of that list is the veterans, and they say that in the article. This is actually really focused towards the veterans who have post-traumatic stress disorder, which, of course, they concocted that post-traumatic stress disorder so that then they could go and basically use the veterans as lab rats with all these chemicals and vaccinations and the mind control technology. So they're really, really interested. When I say they, I'm talking DARPA. I'm talking Pentagon, really, really interested in controlling the brain. And this is this particular technology here, this one that the MIT Technology Review is talking about. It's, again, it's an electrical brain implant, and that is designed to control emotions, thoughts, and feelings. I mean, Orwellian doesn't even describe this. And here's the real scary thing that I often think about. These chips, these brain implants, are obviously they're really interested in implementing this in soldiers too, which is later on in the article. But what's really scary is how small these chips are. We're not talking about like the motherboard of your computer and somehow sticking that on your head. We're talking about microscopic implants. Implants that will probably be able to be delivered into your system via nanotechnology in the future. In other words, you could get pricked with something in the future and have miniature microchips introduced into your bloodstream or whatever and into your body. I mean, this is not science fiction. This is Pentagon DARPA-funded technology that's going to be rolling out pretty soon. But the one that and I'm just giving people examples here so they know that what we're talking about is not fantasy. This is now. This is here and now. The one that I always talk about, because I think it is the most in the vein of Genesis 6 in the antediluvian world, and I mention it all the time because it really does demonstrate that this is all going full circle, is the solicitation that DARPA made, which
Hebrew definitions of Nephal, N-I-P-H-A-L, is to come down into and penetrate, okay? But it's literally a true statement to say they inserted themselves into the human genome. Now listen to this. This is where Jude deals specifically with what Timothy just basically spelled out in the realm of supernatural rape. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire, likewise also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. Now, that's not just talking about an earthly entity. Now, how about this? Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, did not or durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke thee." But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, and those things they corrupt themselves. That brute beast is not talking about just the nature of a fallen man. This is talking about entities. Now look at this. Woe unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain, and greedily after the heir of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Kor. All I'm saying to most people tonight, and Tim is saying, this stuff is upon us. Now to bring you fast forward. Tim, will you do me a favor? Are you where you can email me back the email that I sent you
yes.
with the lady who had the recent experience? If you'll send that, I'm going to paraphrase it. But I'd like to have it just to see if I leave out any details. I was sent an email by a woman who's basically been chased. She's not seeing anyone. She's not been with a man. She sounded like a genuine sister in the Lord. She said to me, and I am praying for you, and we will pray for all people who are oppressed tonight of the devil. And John Quayle, blessings to you. I just bless my brother John Quayle. No man that I know right now, and anybody that is so selflessly trying to get people free and setting free. Now, I don't know all the deliverance ministers. I know that Shannon Davis prays for people on the radio, and God bless his efforts, and the other men who minister on his show to set people free. But we're laying out for everyone to understand. This lady sends me an email, and it basically said, I've been chased, I'm getting to the bottom line, and I was raped by an entity. When a woman is raped by an entity, it's incubus. When a man is raped by a female entity, it's succubus. And ladies and gentlemen, if you don't think this is relevant tonight, when you're reading Psalm 91, the terror that comes by night was a Lilith, it's talking about Lilith the night hag. And in the desert settings, the female demoness would literally, and I got to be careful here because I don't want to be graphic, but let me just say this. The word man-eater, this beautiful woman would appear as a beautiful woman, rape the man, and then turn into the beast and devour them, literally eat their flesh. So in Psalm 91, when it talks, you won't be afraid of the terror that comes by night, okay? That's what it's talking about. People don't understand the specificity, there's a good word, for the Word of God. So the point being is when you're talking about what Tim and I are talking about, and I just told the woman that got raped, she ended up the following day, which she said, genital herpes pimples all over her, you know, private area. Now, is this to be talked about? Absolutely. The point being is this, is that I have seen too many people go into the night and walk away from the Lord because they'd seek help from ignorant, and I would say this, cowardly pastors who didn't have the words to set them free. And it's out in Jesus' name. And it's with the faith to know that. So what we're seeing in Jude 1, 6 through 11 is the angels which kept not their first state. In other words, they didn't stay in heaven. They were drawn away by their lusts. And it's an interesting thing. That word lust is amazing to me. It's epitomia in Greek. And this is amazing too. It is a desire, a craving for that which is forbidden. I asked the Lord years ago, and for those of you who have listened to me for two decades or better than two decades on the radio, I said, Lord, what's lust? And here's what he said, and I'll give it right back to you, Tim. It's the appetite of demons expressed through humans. Now, that's pretty telling. The appetite of demons expressed through humans. If you look at if I had to give you one statement, that's basically taking over the world. It doesn't matter if it's Germany passing a law that basically you can have sex, incest is going to be legal. I believe I stand corrected if I'm wrong, but I believe that they passed a law that sex with animals is legal, bestiality. The basis of all bestiality is simply this, and it's a basis of the Canaanite religions. The Canaanite religions practice incest, so do the Illuminati. The point being is that every barrier that God has placed for our safety now is broken down. And Tim, I'm going to turn it over to you. And I think we need to actually help the people to understand that this isn't a graphic novel. This isn't Monday night titillation ceremony. These are the actual things that are going to be released in the earth and are being released. Forgive me, not will be, are being released. When the gates of hell are open, the bottom line is that I don't think people understand. That means everything that's been held back for our safety out of God's commensurate, immeasurable love for us, the redemption of the King of Glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, is now being loosed and it's manifesting. Go ahead, Tim.
That's right. The term incubus, by the way, and succubus, I want to clarify this for people. That is what people have labeled these things, but don't be fooled in thinking that there's only two kinds of entities that can screw around with you physically, that one's called incubus and the other's called succubus. That's not the case. I'm not sure, Steve, but I think that the incubus and succubus came out of the medieval times, the terminology. But basically, my point is this. a lot of these entities, there's multitudes of them, they have the capability to interact with us in the material realm, in the corporeal world. Let me give another example here. This is actually pretty interesting, Steve, because when I was in Peru, I had a good friend. His name is Carlos. He and I would actually – this is when I was first coming studying giants and everything, and there was a particular evening. It just so happened, Steve, that we were reading some of your stuff together, looking some stuff up, the Genesis 6 giants and all kind of stuff. And we ended up that evening, that night – talking about, for some reason, incubus and succubus. I don't remember why we were talking about incubus and succubus, because we started off talking about giants and Genesis 6 and all that. And it was about, I'd say, again, it was probably somewhere around 1 in the morning. My wife and child were asleep. Everybody was asleep. And my friend Carlos and I were sitting in my office, in my home, in Tarapoto, Peru. And we're having this conversation about incubus and succubus. Can't remember the details of it, but I know that's what it was about. Now, my friend Carlos had a cell phone. This cell phone is one of those prepaid cell phones, the ones you buy and you put the little chip in it. And nobody had his number. Actually, I shouldn't say nobody. Let me be clear. Three people had his number, me and two friends of ours. That's it. And nobody else had.
You and thank you, because this is the way it's supposed to work. Each one is to carry each other's burden, and so that's why we spend so much time on Hagman and Hagman as the Lord leads, praying for people. Thank you all very, very much. And tonight we're going to try, Tim and I, by the grace of God, are going to lay out to you the confusion in the terminology that keeps people from truly identifying not only the enemy. Everybody can look to see Satan as the root of it all, but they don't understand the different terms and why Genesis 6 is so critical, and why the church and organized religion won't touch this with the truth of God's word, and why it's been pretty much hidden through the ages. Because when you start talking about fallen angels, when you start talking about war in heaven, when you start talking about sexual impurity, and so much so that a third of the angels fell, not in the original rebellion, in the original rebellion, but only 200 of them came to earth as watchers on Mount Hermon in the Middle East and had sex with the earth woman. Now, we're going to open with the scripture, and I want everyone to take notes, because it's imperative that you understand this. There are so many people using and misusing the word Nephilim. Most people don't even address the word Rephaim, and most people call Nephilim demons. It's not the case. And in order to understand this, because as Tim and I go into the evening and we share with you the not only the ancient text, but the actual words in Hebrew and in Greek, a picture is painted that has been kept from the people of God. You know, Doug, Joe, and Tim, I just got off the phone with a lady that said, I don't even know how I heard about you, but I was praying, and the Lord said, I want to teach you the nature of the war that you're going to be fighting. And she said, I was led to you. And ladies and gentlemen, the point is that it's the message that is critical. You're all charged by the living God to take these things to the scripture and to pray about them. And I find it's interesting, Doug, you know, most people will deal with sex. They deal with it in you know, the righteously so and rightfully so in marriage. But if you notice the nature of the battle now throughout all of the media and through all of the different portals from hell, everything is becoming more and more perverse. And I think it goes to the amazing words of Jesus. And again, everything that Jesus said has such a depth of, a depth to be mined to understand what he is really saying, that when he's calling people, ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father will you do also. I mean, he's making a statement, and so we're going to get to that. But tonight we're going to open, and Tim and I are going to go back and forth as Pastor Langford and all guests do. But this is critical. People, you need to open your Bible, and you need to write these scriptures down, because they mean what they say and say what they mean, and because of the organized religious world avoiding it doesn't make it not true. Genesis 6, starting at the first verse. And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became the mighty men which were of old, men of renown. And God said, and God saw the wickedness of man that was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. I think the idea of the fall of man and the denial of the true person of the devil who became the adversary, Satan means the adversary, that Genesis 6 is what I call the Rosetta Stone to understanding history. Up until the time of a French explorer, if you will, Champollion, no one could rightfully and accurately read hieroglyphics, but with the archaeological find of the Rosetta Stone, which was written in three languages, in other words, the same passage, but it was written kind of, if you will, as a primer to be able to translate hieroglyphics into Dometic, and then Dometic was kind of almost a syllable by syllable sound, we'd call it a phonetic alphabet, and then into Greek. So with that understanding through the Rosetta Stone, R-O-S-E-T-T-A stone, came the understanding of hieroglyphics. And it's interesting, Doug, it's interesting, Joe, it's amazing, Tim, that when the Tower of Babel was built, and obviously Nimrod, and we're going to get to him later in the show, that there was a desire of mankind to escape the flood and to build a tower whose height reached to heaven. It was so real and such an affront against the living God that he scrambled the languages on the plains of Shinar. Well, right now, as the world comes together in a global, if you will, rebuilding of not only the Tower of Babylon, but the last, if you will, expression of a global government, a global religion, and a global financial system, it's Babylon 2. And it was interesting because there was a science fiction show that took place in space by that name. But getting back to Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, here's what I think people need to understand. It was Arthur Cousins who said, the climax was at the beginning. When God so chose in the book of Genesis to make it clear, he didn't give at that point the total, forgive me, Moses in writing Genesis didn't give the entire account, but he gave enough to show that there was a heavenly interference on earth. And for the people, we'll get to the whole thing of sons of God and who they were, etc. But one of the words that's interesting that shows up three times in the Old Testament is the word Nephilim, N-E-P-H-I-L-I-M. And over the course of the last, I don't know, probably 20 years since I started talking about it, I've seen the most strange renditions of that. And Tim and I were talking, and before I go into the Hebrew and all that stuff, the point is that Nephilim is not the same as Rephaim. People use Nephilim as giants. Nephilim are not giants. Nephilim are fallen angels. The giants, eight times in the Old Testament, are spoken of in the valley of the Rephaim, or they're from the root word Rapha, R-A-P-H-A. Demons are the disembodied spirits of the giants, half heaven, half earth. And you know, Doug, Joe, and Tim, God, and I'm turning right over to Tim, God set a balance. He set a separation. In the book of Genesis, he said, everything after its likeness and after its kind. Since that decree went forth, the devil and all of his fallen angels, one-third of the angels in heaven fell, have been trying to distort, destroy, mix, intermingle, genetically alter, genetically pervert, and basically do every form of attack on the human genome created in the image and likeness of the living God. Go ahead, Tim. Share, if you would, just what's on your heart, because obviously God has raised you up to deal with these issues and in a pretty remarkable way. Ladies and gentlemen, the Alberino analysis, if you'll go on my website, stevequayle.com, is probably one of the most And I say this not to flatter.
Really intense intercession. So there was always supernatural stuff happening around us because we were engaging the supernatural. We were engaging the atmosphere, and there was a lot of pushback. So I warned this young man. I said, listen, if you come down to Peru, you have to understand that you're walking into a war zone, especially if you're going to get enveloped with us. You've got to be prepared. And, you know, he assured me he was. And he came down to Peru, and he didn't have a real – this guy had a very superficial relationship with the Lord. I would question whether he really did know the Lord. But to give him the benefit of the doubt, I'll just call it a superficial relationship with the Lord. But anyways, he comes to Peru, and within the first week – I would say within the first couple of days, he was living down – the road from my wife and I. We were staying with some friends. He was staying in like an apartment room down the road from us by himself. And I think it was the second night or the third night, he came to the door of the house that I was staying at around 1 or 2 in the morning. And I hear this knocking at the door, and he's calling my name, and he's calling my name frantically. And so I went to the door, and I opened the door, and listen, this guy, he had the crap scared out of him. I mean, he was pale. His skin was pale. He was sweating. He was shaking like a leaf. And the look on his face was utter horror. And I said, what's the problem? And he said, I have to talk to you. I have to talk to you right now. And he started to break down and cry. So he came in, we sat down, and he was weeping for a couple of minutes, and I said, what happened? He said, and I'm sorry if this is a big pill to swallow for people tonight, but he looked at me and said, I just got raped by something. And basically he was, and by the way, this young man was definitely playing with sexual immorality. That's a key point here. He was playing with fire before he came to Peru. Okay, so he told me he just got raped by an unseen entity, and he began to tell me what happened. And basically, without going into the details, obviously, he was having a dream. He was having a normal dream, laying in his bed on his back, having a normal dream, but then suddenly his dream was interrupted, and it went to another level. There's probably some listeners who understand what that's like. When you're having a sort of a normal dream that's not really important, and maybe kind of a ridiculous dream, and then all of a sudden your dream gets notched up to a whole new level, and you are consciously aware that something's going on. You know you're dreaming, and either it's really good or really bad what's happening in your dream. It's either God giving you a message, or it's somebody else infiltrating your dreams. And so he was in that heightened state of dreaming all of a sudden, and of course he had the sleep paralysis, and he was now in between being awake and being asleep, and this entity entered his dream and basically became his dream. It was this female entity, and it was coming on to him, and it was he said at first it presented itself in an attractive form, and so it started to come on to him, and so he responded, and basically he was making out with this entity in the dream, and then of course they started to round third base, and suddenly he woke up, and he was no longer in the sleep paralysis state. He was wide awake. But he was stuck to his bed. He was literally being pushed down into his bed. And there was an entity on top of him. The bed was being pushed down by the extra weight. It was a full-on physical experience. But I can't really remember if he could see the entity. I think he did, but I don't want to over-exaggerate. I don't want to exaggerate, but he definitely could feel it. It was a physical presence. It was pushing him down, and it was having sexual intercourse with him, and it was a female entity, and it was terrifying because he definitely did see it, at least a glimpse of it, because it wasn't beautiful anymore. Now it was a terrifying, demonic, horrifying entity that was raping him, and he was literally held down to his bed, and basically became, you know, like a prostitute to this entity. It was having its way with him, and there was nothing he could do about it. And it was abusive. It began to become very abusive and dig its claws into him, and it was a terrifying experience for him. Believe me, this was not a pleasurable experience for this young man. He was absolutely terrified. And the thing started to move around his room. I think it knocked some things over. I think it was growling. There was a whole scene going on. So there's physical contact going on. And he didn't know what to do. And because he had opened the door, he really didn't have the authority. He was disarmed spiritually. And I'm not going to go into the details of exactly why, but it had to do with sexual immorality. He had a door open before he came to Peru. And he entered the battlefield, and, something took advantage of that open door in his life. And that's why I always tell people, when the Bible says that not to give the devil a foothold, that's literal. It's not just metaphoric. It's not just poetic language. It's literal. If you give the devil a foothold, in other words, the old saying, if you give him an inch, he'll take a mile. If you crack the door open for him, he's going to bust it open. And obviously, depending on the state of where you are with the Lord and everything like that, will determine what happens at that point. But this young man was not on solid ground, and so he paid the price. And he was, like I said, he was white as a ghost, shaking like a leaf, bawling his eyes out. Nothing like this had ever happened to him in his life. And so this is the reality. So when we talk about sentient entities or sentient beings or non-human entities or whatever terminology we're using, we're not talking about spirits that just float around like clouds and just kind of drift in and out of rooms like ghosts. Get the idea of just ghosts out of your head. These are flesh, in some cases, flesh and blood. In other cases, they're quasi-supernatural. In other words, they can be flesh and blood one moment, and then they move into another dimension or realm or whatever, or dematerialize or whatever they do. But they have physical interaction, and this guy learned that the hard way.
Well, I think it's important too that people understand that there's a scripture for this. One thing that I've always asked the Lord, I said, Lord, help me not to veer, help me not to stray. And I've been rebuked by so many, and I'll just say this: ignorant Jezebel-like creatures. And I'm not even sure. I basically have, you know, people said, do you know what they say about you? I said, I don't care what they say about me. What does the Bible say about all this stuff? And here it is, Jude 1, 6 through 11. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains unto darkness, unto the judgment of the great day. People said, well, Jesus said there's no sex in heaven. Absolutely, not in heaven. But these guys left their first estate. That means they didn't stay in the heavenly realm, and they intermingled themselves with the seed of man. By the way, one of the derivations, I found this, it blew me away, Tim, I didn't know this. Basically, one of the offspring. You know, it's interesting, Tim, Doug, and Joe, that the Bible teaches very clearly that Satan can transmutate or change his form and appear as an angel of light. Tim and I will get to that later on in the show, and we're going to talk specifically about the Book of Giants, which is a Dead Sea Scroll found in the Qumran caves, along with the different fragments of Scripture. The problem is that people will look to an alien savior, but they will not look to the God who spelled it all out for them so they wouldn't be deceived. And Scripture says because they choose to believe a lie, God gives them up that they might believe a lie. One of the things I get into a lot of, email discussion, and people take me on over my biblical stance. When you tell me that the aliens created us, my first question, and I think you and I talked about this, Doug, and you don't have to answer because you're through, but I'm just saying we've talked about it, is the fact that who created the aliens? And I find it interesting that the alien gods that people want to worship are always related mythologically and through legends and through oral tradition with the sexual act of supernatural beings producing offspring in the women. Now, the word Rephaim, which is a derivation of Rapha, and that's a pretty interesting thing. It basically talks about ghosts of the dead, shades, or spirits. And I think Chris Putnam's got something written on shades. But here it is. I'm going to give people, if you look at the word dead in the Old Testament, and please take these, it's important for the sake of this talk tonight that I give these scriptures so people can go and look it up in the Hebrew Concordance, either Strong's or Young's, okay? Job 26:5 says this, dead things are formed from under the waters and the inhabitants thereof. Now look at that, dead things. Okay, people say, well, what are they talking about, drowned ghosts? No, they're talking about, I'll say this, the giants or the Rephaim are formed from under waters. That's the word, and the inhabitants thereof. Now, how about this? Psalm 88:10. Wilt thou show wonders to the dead? Shall that dead rise and praise thee? Salah. How about Proverbs 2:18? For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead, unto the Rephaim. Proverbs 9:8. But he knoweth not that the dead are there, and her guests are in the depths of hell. The sexual connotation of the whole fallen angel, and let's just call it intergalactic or interdimensional hanky-panky, is beyond question. The bottom line is you can't get away from the Greek gods, the Greek myths. You can't get away from the Egyptian myths. You can't get away from any of the Babylonian myths. You can't get away from the Epic of Gilgamesh, the oldest poetic narrative in the world. You can't get away from Nimrod. You can't get away from this stuff in history because it infiltrates every aspect of the secret society and the occult worship of Lucifer. Okay, how about Proverbs 21:16? The man that wandereth out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. That's the Rephaim. This is one of my favorites, Isaiah 14:9. Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. It stirreth up the dead, Rephaim, for thee, even all the chief ones of the earth, it has raised up from their thrones, and all the kings of the nations. Isaiah 26:14 and Isaiah 26:19. They are dead, they shall not live, they are deceased, they shall not rise. Therefore hast thou visited and destroyed them, and made all their memory to perish. Isaiah 26:19, thy dead men shall live together with my dead body shall they arise. Awake and sing, ye that dwell in dust, for thy dew is a dew as herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead. That again is the word Rephaim. So every time you see the word dead in that context of those passages, I think there's eight of them, you've got to understand it's speaking about the Rephaim. So it's real simple. Again, we're going to build on this. The Nephilim are the fallen ones. The Rephaim are the giants. The word Rephaim and Nephilim are not interchangeable, though current usage and confusion would make it so. And as Tim just spelled out, a UFO is not a Nephilim. You're talking about, in essence, it's almost like some of the fallen angels may have had their wings clipped, pun intended, and had to use the technology of the ancients. I was told, Doug, Joe, and Tim, by a multi-star general beyond most people's ability to understand rank in the military, that the idea of the understanding that they've been given are of so many sentient beings in the universe that they basically battle so many of them. It's kind of like in our, if you will, understand the world, we got three things, and they're all rolled into one. We have, obviously, fallen angels. We have giants, and we have the demons. A demon literally means a disembodied spirit. A demon has to inhabit something. A demon can inhabit an inanimate object. It can inhabit an animal. It can inhabit just about anything, idols, stone, whatever, until they ultimately become if you will, animated in their own body or take possession of another. So what we're talking about, too, is when a demon enters in, when an unclean spirit enters in, let's take the words of Jesus, the gathering demoniac. The gathering demoniac was chained to a wall, but the demons in him, which were named Legion, produced so much strength that the chains couldn't hold him until Jesus, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, commanded that unclean spirit, the unclean Legion, to come out of him. And those demons, what did they do? They begged to go into the pigs. and then the pigs immediately ran off the cliffs and drowned. And it's fascinating because one of those scriptures of Rephaim is specifically talking about that which is under the sea. So the point is that the demons are what are manifesting, and I'm going to ask Tim to share, I'm going to share an email that I got from a lady. I'll hide her identity, so sister, if you're listening, don't worry. But Tim, I want you to share what happened, because I think people need real-life instances. We're not here to scare you. We're here to tell you that in my name ye shall cast out devils. God has given us power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. So, Tim, share about the gentleman, and obviously you don't need to share his name. Don't share any names, but just share about the experiences that you had with this sort of stuff in Peru.
Yeah, specifically the idea, many people are familiar with the terms incubus and succubus, which basically refer to entities, demonic entities that actually, for lack of a better term, rape human beings. And that's not in an imaginary sense. That's in a very literal sense. That sounds bizarre to most Americans because that kind of stuff is under the radar here. It's happening here, as Steve's going to demonstrate, but it's under the radar here, whereas if you go to third world countries, things are much more overt and in your face. In fact, there was for the listeners who don't know, I lived in the Amazon basin of Peru for 10 years. So there was a young man from a church in the United States that wanted to come down and spend some time in Peru with us. And we were engaged, my wife and I, and a team of Peruvian people in
Tim, but it's one of the most laser-like presentations of some of the most difficult things to understand, but Tim has a gift of making it simple. Go ahead, Tim, and respond, if you would, to the general statement that everything's a Nephilim.
Yep. On that note, I want to let everybody know that we just upgraded the analysis. That's going to be coming out tomorrow or Wednesday, so there's an upgraded version coming. But yeah, the word Nephilim, for some time now I've been bothered by this very general use of the term Nephilim. The word Nephilim has become a trendy part of people's vernacular. And there's a tendency to over-apply it lackadaisically and to generalize when dealing with the reality of non-human sentient beings. And even the term non-human sentient beings throws people for a loop, because people can understand the idea of giants, but it's hard for them to then apply the same kind of logic to understanding the existence of other sentient non-human entities. And the reality is that the days in which we live are going to be, especially the days that are coming in the future, are going to be filled with the reality of non-human sentient entities. And we can just point to the book of Revelations to verify that. There's all kinds of creatures appearing on the scene at the end of the age. And so I think it's important for us to be able to get away from the term Nephilim in the way that it's being used and begin to break down the paradigm of what's actually happening on the earth right now. And what really disarms people is when when a term is used so amorphously, so generally, that it begins to lose its meaning, or it begins to be applied to every single situation that is unexplainable or that has to do with non-human intelligence. And I'll give you an example. I've heard people refer to UFOs as Nephilim. In fact, this is quite common. And I think that this is something that people need to start correcting. I really believe that this isn't just an issue of semantics. This is something this is a paradigm shifter, what Steve and I are talking about tonight. This is a paradigm shifter for people. People need to shift out of the common cookie-cutter paradigms and move into understanding reality. It's so convoluted. There's so much going on that we've got to have our heads screwed on right, and we've got to have our minds wrapped around some of the terminology and some of the issues that are going on. And so, again, going back to this issue of people labeling UFOs or flying saucers or aeronomical unidentified or unexplainable aeronomical phenomenon as Nephilim. And again, this is very common. So the problem with that is, and I understand where people are coming from. They're wanting to say that that is evil, that's wicked, that's of the devil. And in that sense, they're accurate. But in describing a vehicle as a Nephilim, they're missing a whole lot of information that they need to start to understand. For example, an aircraft, a UFO, a flying saucer is hardware. It's hardware. It can crash. It can explode. It can be brought down with centralized or focused radar systems or missiles. It's hardware. So we have a lot of things going on in the atmosphere. For example, using the UFO situation as an example here, there's a lot of things flying around in the atmosphere, and none of what's actually flying around, in my opinion, it can be rightfully labeled with the term Nephilim. Now, some of the entities flying the craft maybe might fit some of that terminology, and obviously fallen angels are involved. So, again, my hope tonight is to kind of help people break down some of the confusion, because fallen angels, or some people like to call them archons or watchers, like I always say, that's the term angel is a very broad general term. And there are a lot of fallen creatures, in my opinion, that it's not just my opinion. This can be verified in Scripture. Obviously, the giants that came of the Nephilim, that came of the Watchers, are a different – there's different categories. So the fallen angels are very, very distinct from the giants. They're human hybrid offspring. But see, the fallen angels didn't just screw around sexually with human women. And we're going to get to this a little bit later when we talk about the Book of Giants. They intentionally screwed around with all kinds of animals, and not just a couple. And again, we'll get to the details in a little while. So what you have now is you literally have a situation where there are multitudes of creatures, sentient creatures. When I say sentient, I'm talking about conscious. They have the ability to think consciously like us. They have the ability to reason and to and they're intelligent, and in many cases, they're far more intelligent than we are, and they're going to be showing up on the scene pretty soon. This is a safeguard, by the way. This is a safeguard against deception. This isn't just peripheral information. This is information that is going to help people, if they apply it and take it seriously, it's going to help them recognize, discern, and identify the things that are happening on the earth, because the kind of stuff we're talking about tonight, namely sentient non-human creatures, because that's what the giants were. They were hybrids. They were only partly human, and that's what all the other creatures that came of the fallen angels mixing their seed with the animals and other creatures. And so we're dealing with this litany of beings that are going to start showing up, at least some of them. And when they do, if you don't have a grid, if you don't have a paradigm that's ready for it, it's going to throw you for a loop, and that's putting it lightly. I mean, listen, people are going to lose their faith. Some people are going to lose their minds over some of the stuff that's coming, and I don't mean to be ambiguous. Specifically, there is this whole alien question that we've got to wrap our minds around. We've got to start to understand the alien question. We have to understand UFOs better. That doesn't mean that you have to become a ufologist, but we've got to understand this stuff, not only in a biblical context, which is the most important, but also in the context of reality, what is actually taking place on the earth right under our noses. Steve?
Well, I think it's important, too, to understand the words, and this is what's interesting. In Genesis 6:4 and Numbers 13:33, where the word Nephilim is used in the Hebrew, it literally translates from the word Nephal, Some people pronounce it Nepal. And by the way, the country of Nepal, or Nepal, where the Mount Everest is called the Mountains of the Fallen Ones. Just a little curiosity there. But some of the greatest scholars, okay, specifically say that the word Nephilim refers to the fallen angels themselves and not to their offspring, which brings me to a word for their